entitled Building Your Financial Fortress, a Christian Financial Planning Webinar. Especially during this pandemic time, I think all of us, many of us are struggling in this area. And it is always good to plan ahead, to be sure of what's going to happen rather than be caught off guard. So that's why we thought this will be a good webinar for us. And we are so glad that you can come and join us. I believe that you will be blessed. But before we go on, I'd like to give you some housekeeping rules. First, for all participants, kindly do not unmute yourself during the webinar so as not to cause any distraction, but to allow the speaker to speak freely without disturbance. If you do have any questions or you have any difficulties, you can use the reaction button with the hand raise, right? You can try it now, just put up your hand raise. Then we have an ushering team that's always on the lookout, looking out for you. Anything they can, you need help, they will come connect with you. Or like you can also text and call the person, the phone number there that will be there that will can help you also. Right. We will have Q&A question also that after, because we got two sessions today, we will start at 2 o'clock, we will finish about 45 with a Q&A, then we will have a break. After the break, then we have session two. At the end of session two, we also have Q&A. So during the session, while it's going on, while our speaker is speaking, you can start keying in the questions that you might have, so that we can tabulate, and towards at the end of each of the session, we will have a short time of Q&A, all right? So you can start typing in your question along the way. All right, if everything is set, can we just open this time with a word of prayer? Let's pray. Father, we want to thank you for your goodness and mercy, for your grace over our lives. We know, God, that during this pandemic, during this MCO lockdown, many people are struggling. But we know you are always good and you're always watching over us. We thank you, O God, that we can always turn to you and cry out to you that you will be there for us. And even today, we want to commit today's webinar into your hands. Lord, that as we plan ahead, it will help us to be more prepared to whatever struggles, no matter what season of life that we are faced with, that we should always plan ahead, O God. Thank you, O Jesus. We thank you for the availability of our speaker here today. May you anoint him as he shares his word with us. And open our hearts and help all of us that we will have no difficulties in our Wi-Fi and we can follow and learn as much as possible. Bless our time together. We thank you. We commit all this to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Today we are so glad that we have our speaker available to be with us. Right, our brother Rajan Devadasan is a Malaysian Securities Commission licensed financial planner and the CEO of corporate consultancy RD Wealth Creation Sindran Bahad. Right. He attends Agape Community Church in Seremban, where he serves in the children's church, choir, and connect group ministries. Rajan has taught Sunday school and children's church classes over the last 36 years in 3 countries. Wow. He has written or co-written 10 books and currently writes the weekly financial planning column for the New Sunday Times newspaper and less frequently the Christian Financial Planning column for Asian Beacon magazine. He teaches regular webinars on financial planning and retirement planning, which are open to a global audience. Right. Rajan graduated in 1988 with an honors degree in physics and computing from King's College, University of London. And he has worked in UK, US, and Singapore. Now, as we were planning for this topic on financial matters, And I was praying, God, who can we bring in to speak? And that week, as I was driving, I turned on my radio to BFM. And as I was listening, there was a talk on financial planning and financial matters. And the speaker, lo and behold, it was Brother Ranjan. And I recognized his voice. I said, this must be the man. He's the man of the hour for this time to speak to us, to give us wisdom, and so that we can plan ahead, that we can go through whatever challenges that comes our way. Amen. So we are so glad to welcome our brother Ranjan Devadesan. Let's give him a big round of applause. All right, over to you, Brother Ranjan.
Thank you very much, Pastor Daniel. I think I actually want to sort out some housekeeping first. Pastor David, since you seem to be the main technical person, can you unmute yourself? I want to just double check. Is my audio volume okay? Is everything clear?
Perfect.
Okay. So what we're going to be doing is running from 2 to 2:45 and then we'll open the Q&A. But if for whatever reason, the Q&A actually is a little bit slow, and Pastor David, I need you to take care of all the timing issues so that you unmute and you actually tell me. Because frankly, when I get started, I have a tendency to just keep going and I lose track of time. Okay. If there are questions, I'm happy to deal with them. If there aren't, I will then just continue with what I want to say until about 2:55. And then maybe we'll have a 5-minute comfort break so people can go grab a drink, go to the bathroom, whatever else. And then we will restart again at 3 o'clock sharp. And then I need you to decelerate me at 3:45 so we have a proper Q&A. Would that be okay, Pastor David?
Yep, sure.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you very much. So everyone, thank you so much for the invitation. I am deeply, deeply honored to be here. And I bring you greetings from Agape Community Church in Seremban. My senior pastor is Reverend Benjamin Yeo. And he and Pastor Daniel, I believe, know each other very, very well. So I'm honored. I'm going to dive straight in. I'm going to be speaking to you on Christian financial planning. Can I just tell Nancy Yeo, you're upside down right now, which is most interesting. You might want to flip things around. Most of the time, I speak on secular financial planning. I run a holistic financial planning practice. My specific practice focus, however, is retirement planning and retirement funding. And then when I'm invited either by Christian parachurch organizations or churches, and then I actually speak on Christian financial planning. Whether I'm speaking on Christian financial planning or secular financial planning, the one thing that I always say is that I'm not speaking to you from a position of great strength and enormous expertise. I'm actually speaking to you from a position of weakness. Academically, degree-wise and all that, my degree is actually in physics and computing. And I sort of stumbled into financial planning several years after graduation and after a few other jobs. But the reason that my interest in financial planning was triggered was because of monumental mistakes that I actually made in the UK, where I originally went there on scholarship, but the scholarship didn't come from the Malaysian government or any Malaysian company. The scholarship actually came from the UK A-level college that I attended. It was a real blessing, but even though the fees were covered, the tuition charges were covered, living expenses were still required, and things were actually quite tough. And then when I finished my A-levels, I got straight A's. I came back to Malaysia and I applied like crazy to get scholarships, and I got zero, absolutely nothing. All this for me was from 1982 to 1989. And so I went back to the UK, I started studying, but I was constantly short of money. And the only way that I could, even though I was working illegally, by the way, I was working illegally as much as I possibly could, right now, whether you're studying in the US or the UK or Australia or, you know, normal destinations, your student visa actually allows you a certain number of hours of work. So it's legal. But my student permit was very clear. It wasn't legal. But I worked as much as I could. And even then, money wasn't enough. And so what happened was I started receiving in the post credit cards as a student, because the UK banks had already worked out, if you can get the UK graduates to become customers as early as possible, they will be your customers for life. And then I received one credit card, and then I received two, and then I received three. And you suddenly found that you could actually bounce one thing against the other. Now, I never went into default, but the UK debts began to mount up. Then I graduated. I did my A-levels. I graduated. And then I worked in the UK for a while. And then I came back. When I came back, I had a stack of UK credit card debt. And it took me a long time to convert the bulk of my meager Malaysian young graduate earnings in ringgit to sterling and to send it back to the UK and to pay off my credit card debts. It took me years. Now, remember, I said, I'm not speaking to you from a position of strength or even, you know, great authority. It's weakness. I am a very, very slow learner. So when I finished off paying my UK credit card debts in Malaysia, after several years of working at it, to celebrate, I got into Malaysian credit card debt. And that required some more digging out. But I had learned skills. And along the way, it became a little bit easier. So I just want to let you know, I don't know whether you are listening to this because you're already really managing your money very, very well. And you just want to know what the Bible actually says about these things. Or whether, like most of us right now, you're having a tough time and you just want some guidance. So I hope that really helps. Now, I'm going to go straight into my screen share. Pastor David, can you unmute yourself? Am I clear?
Yes.
Good?
You are.
Okay. Thank you very much. Yeah. Okay, cool. Now, let me change my pointer style. Laser pointer. Okay. Okay. I move my head because I know what I look like. Christian Financial Planning, building your financial fortress, and welcome and hello, Canaan Church KL. Now, I sent a handout in PDF format, which I hope all of you have. If you don't, if you actually check your chat right now, you will actually find it. You can download it. If you can track along on a different device with the PDF running, that'll be good. And for those of you who actually received that earlier, if you printed it out, that would be ideal. Question you got to ask yourself is, because our title is, it's a topic, our topic is Christian financial planning. Our subject is building your financial fortress. Metaphorically speaking, our financial fortress is based upon the processes and the products and the income streams that we build around us. But metaphorically speaking, might this rather impressive looking castle be a representation of your financial fortress? Question we've got to ask ourselves really is, why are we here on earth? Why exactly? Now, if we go and check out the second page of your handout, you'll see that I actually reference quite a rare Bible version, the Berean Study Bible, BSB. And in Ecclesiastes 3, 11, and the first part of the verse, it says, "He," meaning God, "has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the hearts of men." So the question you got to ask yourself is, do you have any inkling as to why you were put on earth? You're tracking along with your handout, just jot down what you think your life's purpose is. From a Christian perspective, now I'm not, even though this is a Christian financial planning webinar, I'm not expecting you to just give sanitized, tidied up Christian answers. I want you to be as honest as you want to be. You're welcome if you like to ask me as many questions as you like. I'm sure I don't know all the answers, but I'll answer to the best of my ability. And if I don't know, I will either point you to someone who does know, or I will go away and I will research it and I'll come back to you. But be real. And the questions that you ask in the public setting here in this webinar will be questions that you're comfortable asking with other people listening. But if there are questions that you actually want to ask me solo, one-on-one, you're welcome to do that later as well. All I ask is that you tell me that you are from Canaan Church KL and that you attended the webinar and you have a little bit of a question, you know, that sort of stuff. Now, why are we here on earth? So give a real answer, but from a Christian perspective, I want you to stop and think about the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. The Great Commandment says, and it's from Jesus, says that you are to love one another as I have loved you. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples. The Great Commandment is a commandment to love fellow believers, to extend that circle, to love the world, to basically be like Jesus. And the Great Commission, of course, as you well know, is go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. And so if you're kind of struggling, not sure what to write down for, why am I here on earth? You could write down Great Commandment, Great Commission, and then spend a little bit of time looking at the appropriate Bible verses and just mulling over. And then praying to God and saying, Father, because God's word makes it very clear that if any of us lacks wisdom, all we need to do is ask him and he will grant it to us. And so spend time with your father trying to figure out why you're here. Now, I love this C.S. Lewis quote. If we find ourselves with a desire that nothing in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that we were made for another world. C.S. Lewis, by a long shot, is my favorite Christian author. Many of you would have read the Narnia series. I am not a big reader of general Christian books. There are some aspects of theology I'm very interested in. Every time there is a BCM extension course, regardless of what the title of the course is, I figure out some way to actually ask my standard question, which is, can you in your own words explain to me what the Trinity is? Now, I have taught Sunday school, children's church for a long, long time. I was 21 years old when I first started teaching children's church in the UK. Then I taught it in California when I was there for a summer working. And then, you know, in Malaysia for a very long time. And whenever the lesson comes up about, you know, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and I'm trying to explain to the children that, you know, I explain to them what Christians believe about the Trinity. And then I tell them, I really don't understand it. And then I tell them, you know, if any of you wants to go into artificial intelligence and robotics, and one day you build an intelligent looking robot, maybe even an android, who would be smarter? The robot slash android you built or you, the creator? And then all the little kids will basically say the creator, me, I would know more. And then I said, well, then that means that you would understand everything about what you have made, what you have created in the laboratory, but that which you have created would not know everything about you. Then I said, it's the same thing with God. And so I said, we can't fully understand everything, but we can ask God and we can trust him. And so the reason I mentioned that is I don't do a great deal of external reading. I mean, I've got enough trouble just focusing as much on the Bible as I should. But there is a book by C.S. Lewis that I really do love, and it's not one of his fictional works. It is actually Mere Christianity, Mere Christianity. And so I recommend it to you. If you've never read it, get yourself a copy, make it part of your library and read it. It's not terribly thick. It is deeply profound. Anyway, if we find ourselves with the desire that nothing in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that we were made for another world. Okay, and then the Ecclesiastes reference I gave you. He has made everything beautiful in its time. God has set eternity in the hearts of men. For those of you who are tracking along with your handout, you will know that in number three, page three, I've actually got the line printed out. God has set eternity in the hearts of men. This means that dash is not the most important thing in life. And the question we got to ask ourselves is, well, what's not the most important thing in life? And it is most clearly money. Even though it's Christian financial planning, and one would assume that in the word financial, you have a close tie-in with finances, which means a very close tie-in with money. Clearly, money is not the most important thing in life. So for those of you who are a little bit OCD, suffer from obsessive compulsive disorder, and you really want to complete things, then the dash in number three is, this means that money is not the most important thing in life. But none of us can deny money seems to be needed for everything that is truly important. Everything. If you look at number four in your notes, the dash is money, but money seems to have a role to play in every important aspect of life. Now, I'm actually going to go silent for 30 seconds. I'm going to mute myself. I'll check the time and then I'll come back. And I'm actually going to invite you, I'm giving you permission, when we come back, to very briefly unmute yourself and just shout out your brief answers. My question is, what non-financial dimensions of life require the use of some or perhaps even a lot of our money? This is found in point number four in your handout. For those of you not looking at the handout, listen to me. What non-financial dimensions of life require the use of some or perhaps even a lot of our money? I'm going to mute myself for 30 seconds and then I will come back. Excellent. I invite as many of you as would like to just unmute yourself and let's have a short conversation. Anyone?
Can you please repeat what you mentioned, what you require us to think we can't get, I can't get?
Sure. What non-financial dimensions of life, what non-financial areas of life require the use of some or perhaps even a lot of our money? Now, who's the one asking the question? What's your name?
I'm Esther, yeah.
Hi, Esther. Okay, hi. I've got someone here saying JXE, where's the handout? So, and I've got Zoe saying, what handout? So, Pastor Dan, David,
I'm on it.
Okay, but anyone else, those who are actually able to follow what I was saying, any answers?
Hospitalization.
Ooh, very, very good. Who is that?
Mary here.
Okay, thank you, Mary. You're absolutely right. Let me be a little bit transparent right now, okay? I'm actually sort of in semi-isolation in my house in Seremban. My sister, my family background is very weird. If I've got time, I'll tell you guys about it. But I only have one full sibling. My sister was diagnosed as COVID-19 positive a few days ago. She's in isolation in a home. And I've been monitoring her regularly. From a distance. And my wife and I, my wife's name is Rachel. Rachel and I had our first PCR test and we were negative, for which I'm very thankful. But we both have our second vaccinations of Sinovac next week. And I don't know whether you guys know this, but if you are COVID positive, do not go and get your jab done. So what has been going on is, even though my sister is in self-isolation, the costs are actually running and I'm taking care of stuff. And so you're right, It's hospitalization, it's medical, it's very, very expensive. Thank you very much, Mary. Anyone else? What other aspects of life actually?
You're welcome.
Housing.
Who is that? Please identify yourself.
Anna here. I think my biggest spending is housing. Pay for my house loan.
Is that a... Oh, I was about to ask you whether it's rental or mortgage, but it's a mortgage, correct?
Mortgage, yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
It's very, very true. Absolutely. Very good point. I'm going to go back and I am... Okay, thank you, Pastor David.
Education.
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay, everyone, please mute yourself again. And so we don't end up, and I'm going to continue. We don't end up with too much background noise. And we'll continue. We'll come back to this later. So various aspects of life require money. Now, there is an old definition of financial planning that I use pretty much every day when I'm working with my clients or potential clients, or you know, in the old days when it was a case of having live events, or if I happen to be interviewed on TV or radio, or whether it's a magazine interview or a newspaper interview. This particular definition is something that I use all the time. Financial planning is the process of meeting your life goals through the proper management of your finances. Now, many of you, when you think about financial planning, you may actually very often be thinking about insurance or unit trusts or banking or specific loan products or whatever else. And it's true that you need products to be able to build your financial house. But note, financial planning is the process of meeting your life goals through the proper management of your finances. And so it focuses on the process first. Canaan Church KL is in KL. I'm in Seremban. I was born in Malacca, but pretty much all Malaysians at some time or other spend time in KL. And if you spend time in KL, you probably spent quite a lot of time at Suria KLCC. Almost all of us know KLCC. And so we know the Petronas Twin Towers. Now, I want you to just stop and think. What would have happened if back when Mahathir was fourth prime minister, he decided, okay, I want the two tallest buildings in the world side by side. And then the contractors and the subcontractors were just given a piece of land and said, begin. Chaos would have ensued and it would not look as grand as it actually is. To get the buildings up, the drawings, the concept had to be done. The architects had to get everything blueprinted. Later, I'm actually going to teach you my proprietary blueprint to try and achieve financial freedom. And I'm going to take as much time as necessary there because I think it's very valuable. But even though products are important, you know, when you're putting up like the Twin Towers or any other building, you got to make sure that you have your stuff. You got to have your building materials. You got to have your building blocks. You've got to have your glass. You got to have your steel. You've got to have your wiring. You've got to have your brick, your mortar. But before a single product is placed in the correct place so that you end up with the appropriate edifice, you have to get the process sorted out. It's the same thing with financial planning. However, what normally happens for us though is because, you know, I don't know whether we're all Malaysians, but certainly the majority of people here are Malaysians. And Malaysians by and large are incredibly accommodating and incredibly warm people. And that's why when our neighbor's uncle, son's sister comes and talks to us and say, I've just become an insurance agent and would you like to buy something? Very often we say, okay, I'll support you. And then someone else comes with some unit trust product and you say, yes, I'll support you. And then you go to your regular bank and you don't realize that your bank officer is under so much pressure that she actually needs to sell multiple products in multiple areas. And then you say, okay, sounds good. After all, FD rates are very low. And because of that, many of us actually end up with a hodgepodge of different things, but nothing that is fully integrated that comes together. And the reason is we bought product before process. Now, I find that very often when I'm working with new clients, they already have an array of products. And my job is to say, okay, you've got what you've got. That's fine. Let's try and make it work. But let's take a step back and go to process. And the way that you do that is to try and understand your life goals through the proper management of your finances. Okay, we're going to go to a handout exercise. Not all of you have the handout. So maybe if Pastor David can actually make sure that you all have the appropriate bits. I'll just read it out to you for those who don't have it, okay? Since we're talking about financial planning is a process of meeting your life goals, the proper management of your finances, my question is, what are your life goals? I hope you've got at least got like a journal or an exercise book where you're writing things down. If you're only typing into your phone or whatever, if you can, I would suggest that you scramble and get real paper and real pen. It'd be a lot easier. So my question is this. What are your goals in the short term, in the medium term, and in the long term? And I will be very specific. In the short term, what are the goals that you want to accomplish under 2 years from now? Under 2 years from now. This is now July 2021. So between now and June 2023, less than 2 years, what are the goals you want to accomplish? That's short term in my book. The next thing is, what are your medium term goals? That means you want to accomplish them between 2 years from now and 7 years from now, medium term. Maybe it's to buy a house. Maybe it's to pay off your house. Maybe it's to get married. Not sure. And then finally, what are your long term goals? Meaning 7 years to 50 years or beyond. You could have long-term goals that you hope will go way beyond your lifetime. You may actually want to start a foundation. You may want to be able to help fund a charity. I don't know. I'm going to stop talking for 30 seconds so that you can think about your short-term goals, your medium-term goals, and your long-term goals. Start now. Excellent. Okay. Now, during events where I have more time, I actually take the time to listen and, we'll just discuss those various goals. But because we have a slightly different structure where we're going to stop at 2:45, I would like you, if you have any questions tied to your short-term goals, your medium-term goals, and your long-term goals, just jot them down. And during the Q&A, please feel free to ask me. Thanks. Let's continue. Now, if you look at your notes again, on page 4, number 6, the number one overarching key to better financial management is this term, delayed gratification. Delayed gratification. Delayed gratification is actually the exact opposite of another term that psychologists, not so much financial people, but psychologists started using a long time ago. And that term is immediate gratification. So delayed gratification is the exact opposite of immediate gratification. With immediate gratification, you have this sudden urge. Let's say we're talking about a drug addict or an alcoholic, and you have a sudden urge to have a fix or to have your 19th drink for the day. And so you just go for it. Whereas when it comes to delayed gratification, it is the mark of adulthood. Regardless of how old you are, it is the mark of maturity. Are you willing to sacrifice? I don't know your backgrounds. I don't know whether some of you are students, but I would imagine many of you are actually working. And if you're working, I'm pretty sure you actually have a full spectrum of earnings here. There would be some of you who are maybe earning 1,005, 2,000 ringgit per month. There'll be others who are earning maybe 5,000 ringgit per month, others who are earning 10,000 ringgit a month. Might have people who are earning 50,000 or 100,000 a month. I mean, there's a full gamut, full range. But regardless of how much you make, those who exercise delayed gratification are willing to not spend everything they have today and to set money aside so that they can do better things later. That's what it means. So again, just looking at the notes on page 4, number 6, the number one overarching key to better financial management is delayed gratification, which means giving up some things today in the hope of enjoying even better things tomorrow. It is essential for long-term financial success, particularly if your goal is eventually to achieve financial freedom. I want you to write down that term, financial freedom, because we're going to spend a lot of time on it. Question you got to ask yourself right now is financial freedom important to me or not? Is it or isn't it? Okay. Next thing I want you to be aware of is if you actually want to manage your finances well as an individual, whether you work with a professional or whether you do it on a DIY, do it yourself basis, there are two financial statements that you really must understand and that you should construct for yourself. And I recommend that you construct using pen and paper or use an Excel spreadsheet on your computer. The two statements are the net worth statement and the cash flow statement. Net worth statement and cash flow statement. Now, I'm sure that there are some of you who at least have some background in bookkeeping or accounting. And as such, if you've looked at corporate accounts, you are familiar with the P&L, the profit and loss account, and there's something called the balance sheet. Now, the balance sheet of a business, the balance sheet of a company has two parts, assets and liabilities, what the company owns and what the company owes. The net worth statement, you may want to write this down in your notes. The net worth statement is the human equivalent of a balance sheet. And it's got two parts. What do you own and what do you owe? And hopefully what you own is worth more than what you owe. But, and I'm not here to embarrass anyone, if that is not true, calm down. Because it is actually the other statement that is even more important. And that is the cash flow statement. Just as the net worth statement has two parts, assets, liabilities, assets are what you own, liabilities are what you owe, the cash flow statement also has two parts. Really simple. From a financial planning perspective, the cash flow statement is very simple. For those of you who've actually done corporate accounts, you know that a corporate cash flow statement is not simple. It is not intuitive. Because when you're building that, and I'll only just say this very quickly, you start off with a profit figure, and then you've actually got to literally know your stuff, and you've got to add certain things back, and you've got to subtract certain things back. And that gives you, after a lot of work, gives you a very complicated statement, which is your cash flow statement. But the personal cash flow statement is really, really simple. Now, when I finished my degree in London, I got a job with what was then the largest accounting firm in the world. But my degree was in physics and computing. And the reason that I actually got a job as a trainee chartered accountant with the biggest firm in the world at the time, which was KPMG, was because at that time, the UK chartered accounting firms were sucking up 10% of all UK graduates. And it was the easiest way for me to try and stay on in the UK, which was my intention. But what I found was that I was very much a square peg in a round hole. I hated the accounting life. And that's why I left. And one of the problems I had was I had real trouble trying to figure out how to put together a corporate cash flow statement. Personal cash flow statement, many years later, when I became more and more interested in financial planning, very simple, simple enough for someone like me to understand. cash in. Think about a 1 month period. What money do you have coming in? Maybe you've got your salary. Maybe if you're in business, you've got your revenue coming in. Maybe you've got money in fixed deposits. Maybe you've got some dividends coming in. So you've got cash in. Many of us typically have maybe one or two or three or four sources of cash inflow, not many. And then you look at the other side, which is cash outflow. And when you look at that, you realize you've probably got 30 or 40 or 50 line items where money is going out. And so what you want ideally is to have more money coming in than money going out. And so these two statements are absolutely crucial. So just looking at your notes, for those of you who are tracking, on page 5, number 7, what two parts are there in a net worth statement or a balance sheet? As I told you, assets and liabilities. And the next bit, but your long-term financial health is tied to the concept of cash flow as measured by your CFS or cash flow statement. What is that? Just a listing of cash in, cash out. Really, really basic, really, really simple. Now, the other thing that you want to be aware of is, hang on a minute, let me just check. Pastor David, can you please unmute?
Hi, Brother Rajan.
Yep.
You can go on speaking until 2:55 or until we have a break. We can do the Q&A at the end of session 2.
Actually, I'm perfectly all right stopping at, say, about 2:50. Okay. Do you have a buildup of questions?
Right now, we don't have. We don't have.
Oh, yet. Okay. Not a problem. I'll tell you what. Let's do this. I'm just going to keep going. I need you to tell me very gently that it's 2:50. And then at that point, when you stop me so that I'm aware of the time, let me know whether there are questions or not. If there are no questions, I will keep going until 2:55 and then you will stop me and you'll have a comfort break. But if there are questions, when you stop me at 2:50, I will answer until just before 3 o'clock, give everyone a couple of minutes to go to the bathroom or wash their faces, and then we will continue. Pastor David, would that be okay?
Okay.
Thank
you. No problem.
Okay, wonderful. Now, at an individual level, there are basically three parts of a complete financial plan. And they are really, really easy to remember, particularly if you have some kind of a tablet or you've got an iPad or whatever else. Because if you take the word PAD, P-A-D, that's the way that you remember the three parts of a complete financial plan. The first bit is protection, specifically wealth protection. The second bit is accumulation, wealth accumulation. And the last bit is wealth distribution. Now, this is really important. And so I want you, after I have explained what the three areas are, to jot down in your notes which of the three areas is the most important to you. And either for that which is most important to you, or for any of the others, if you're not too clear, you're welcome to ask me questions about wealth protection, about wealth accumulation, about wealth distribution. Wealth protection is mainly, but not exclusively, taken care of by insurance. And most of us need to spend a little bit of time thinking about four different types of insurance. First, we're looking at life insurance, which is really death insurance, but frankly, it's easier for the life insurance companies to market something called life insurance. Death insurance is so morbid, it's actually quite scary. But life insurance, which is death insurance, the second bit that you want to take care of would be your CI, critical illness cover. The third thing that you want to take care of would be your HNS, hospital surgical cover. And the fourth bit is actually PA, personal accident. So those are not the only types of insurance that you can get. For instance, lawyers and doctors, professionals actually carry something called professional indemnity insurance. As a professional licensed financial planner, the legal structure in Malaysia hasn't yet got to the point where we must have professional indemnity insurance, but I already carry that because I think it's really important to have my PI cover. So I told you that wealth protection is taken care of by insurance, but not exclusively so. Now here, when we talk about wealth accumulation, even though this is a Christian setting, I'm going to speak just as though I'm speaking to a secular audience, just to let you know that if you got issues, then, you know, we can talk about them. So under wealth accumulation, definitely we want to talk about savings. Then we want to talk about investing, you know, conventional, regular investing. And then some of you may actually be into speculations, and some people are into gambling. I'm not advocating gambling. I realize this is a Christian event, but I'm not talking about the world as it should be. I'm talking about the world as it is. So let me just say this. There is something called the risk-reward relationship that comes into play as you move up the risk ladder or the risk pyramid. With savings, your money is very, very safe, but the returns are very boring. With investments, you make much better returns, hopefully, over a long period of time. But your level of safety, the level of stability is lower. Then when you go to speculations, it's very wild. And with gambling, you're almost certain to lose your money. There will always be some people who win, but in general, no. I learned, again, during my time in the UK as a young adult, that I had a gambling streak a mile wide. But I found out early in life, before I lost too much money, and because that level of self-knowledge was very helpful to me, I don't gamble. However, I have had situations where I have speculated and I've made enormous amounts of money. Problem is, I've also speculated and lost money. And I actually find myself exercising selective amnesia, meaning I can tell you about the times that my speculations worked very well, but for the times when my speculations went sour and I lost money, I can't really remember very much. And so because there's no consistency in my ability to speculate well, because I think gambling is stupid, for my clients, I only focus in the wealth accumulation space, I only focus on saving and investing. And under wealth distribution in Malaysia, wealth distribution for Muslims is different. This is a Christian event, so I won't waste time with the Muslim side. But if you've got questions for friends or family, you can ask me later. For us Christians, non-Muslims in Malaysia, there are two instruments, wills, which everyone should have, and trusts that not everyone should have, but the trusts typically kick in when you have young children and a lot of money, or, oddly enough, when you have older children whom you do not trust. Then the solution might actually be the establishment of a private trust. So decide for yourself whether you are most interested in wealth protection, wealth accumulation, or wealth distribution, and then feel free to ask me questions later. Typically, when I have a live event and I'm saying, okay, I've covered all three here, wealth protection, wealth accumulation, wealth distribution, the question that we got to ask ourselves is, well, which of these three are you most interested in? Which are you most interested in? And in every event I have ever run around the world and over decades, in every group, the majority is always here. Everyone is most interested in wealth accumulation. So if we have time, I will actually dive straight into that. I'll let Pastor David stop me at the right time.
It's 2:50 already, Brother Rajan.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you very much. So are there questions? Pastor David, are there questions?
So far, there is only one question. But
I'll take it now.
Yeah, but for the rest of everyone, the rest of you, the participants, you can just freely put your questions at the chat box. Okay, we have ushers that will collate all the questions. And please feel free, don't be shy. Just put all the questions there in the chat box. Any hard, easy questions, anything, Brother Rajan can take it. All right, and just go ahead, ask the questions. And there will be another Q&A session, and all of us, with all the questions collated, then we'll give it to Brother Rajan. But so far, right now, we have a question from Zoe Tan, and it's the question is this: is medical insurance an absolute necessity?
Zoe Tan is asking whether medical insurance is an absolute necessity.
That's right.
In my opinion, I would say yes. I don't think life, remember I spoke about the four types, right? I spoke about life insurance. I spoke about CI cover, which is critical illness cover. I spoke about H&S, hospital surgical. So medical really comes under, medical covers CI and hospital surgical. And the last bit I talked about was PA, personal accident. In my opinion, it would be very, very unwise if you can get it. Not everyone can get medical insurance. But in my case, if you can, I would definitely say that I recommend people get the appropriate medical cover. Not everyone needs life insurance. There are two groups of people who don't need life insurance in the Malaysian context. Think about it. Why do you have life insurance? So that when you die, your dependents have money. Now, all the money in the world is not going to make up for the emotional loss of someone that you care about, who is an integral part of your family structure, your social structure. But you know, if you are a breadwinner, whether you're the sole breadwinner or one of a few breadwinners, if you're taken out of the equation, then the life insurance money, in addition to whatever net assets you leave behind, can actually be structured. Okay, Zoe's got an additional thing, but let me finish this. Can additionally be restructured so that an income stream can come through and it will actually replace the economic value of the individual. Okay, so Pastor David, I want to answer the second part of Zoe's question. Can you check the chat and just read it to me?
Yep. So what Zoe asked the question is, what if one believes that the total amount of premium will offset the sudden medical bills if one suddenly contracts a disease?
That's a very valid point. It's easy for me to give this answer because I'm not trying to sell medical insurance to Zoe. Actually, or to anyone else, actually. But my experience has been that the people who try and avoid medical insurance, particularly when they're young and they're healthy and they can probably get it quite cheap, they're actually being penny wise and pound foolish. Remember I told you that my practice, my financial planning practice, covers holistic financial planning. My area of specialty is actually retirement funding. When people look at the definition of financial planning is the process of meeting your life goals to the proper management of your finances. Standard goals that actually appear when people work with someone like me are retirement and medical expenses and kids' tertiary education expenses. Now, in the absence of specific information as to how much your child's future tertiary costs may come to, the rule of thumb that my cohorts, my peers, other licensed financial planners in Malaysia, and I actually I'm a representative of, is that for kids' tertiary education, we use an 8% per annum escalation rate. But for medical costs, based on what's been going on, for a few years now, I have been using 15% per annum. And I've actually spoken to people who are in the business who are saying that insurance companies are actually escalating their premiums because the costs are going up even higher. And I've spoken to people who are even closer to those markets, and they tell me that the escalation in medical costs is like 18 to 20%. So I saw that Zoe actually put something down saying not penny wise, pound foolish, but something about expecting to be in the pink of health forever. I think that is incredibly unwise. Okay, I'm ending that bit. It's now 2:56. Shall
maybe,
we take a...
Maybe one more last question?
Can, no problem. I think happy to.
I think there's one question from Fearless, Fearless LKC. Who said, how much is enough for a retired couple?
That's maybe very, very good. That's a good question. I'm happy to answer that. So if it's a retired couple and it's a couple where the... Okay, so Pastor David, Zoe's got more questions on crypto and stuff. All of this you save to the end.
Yes,
let me come back. Come back to the and Zoe, thank you for your enthusiasm. It's always nice knowing people are asking questions. So for a retired couple, particularly if one of them, and I'll just assume it's a husband, but it doesn't have to be, one of them either is the sole breadwinner or the primary breadwinner, then the numbers for a couple like that would be about the same as for an individual, because you're looking at one household in terms of the retirement. For 25 years, I have been crunching retirement numbers, and it's not a lot, it's only like a few hundred sets, because a very specific type of individual comes to me, and I cannot help everyone, but I can try and help as many as I can. And what I have found is over the years, about 85 to 90% of the numbers that I crunch in terms of the requirement, that, you know, the money that you will need in retirement, 85 to 90% of people fall within this mega big range. 500,000 ringgit minimum up to 20 million ringgit. Now, of course, there are people with more and there are people who need less. So when I'm doing this, let's say it's a global audience coming in and I'm speaking from Malaysia, I then tell them, okay, so I'm a Malaysian practitioner. My license is with the Malaysian Securities Commission. And so people typically ask me this question, but I crunch numbers for people around the world. And then I bring everything back to the ringgit side. Oh, I love this question from Meiping, public health system. I want to answer this. Please make sure it's asked, particularly within the context of this Ketuanan Melayu government that we're seeing right now. I also want to tie my answer at the end to my inability to get a scholarship in the 1980s, and then how things actually improved in Malaysia for non-Malays, and how things are now reverting back. So that's a fantastic question. So I hope I helped the answer the question. Basically, between half a mil and 20 million, and then just put one more twist, and then I will let us all just go for a two-minute comfort break.
We will go for a 5 minutes break, actually. 5 minutes.
Actually, I prefer to just keep it down to two so I can actually get going. Otherwise, I'm not going to be able to cover my material.
Okay,
those fine. Who need a longer break, you just come in and join
all
us.
Right,
but sure. 2 minutes is fine to run to the bathroom, get it, or get a drink, but can't do both. I understand. So the key thing that you actually want to look at is which is the retirement funding model that you want to look at. And this is, write this down if you're interested. I use two models. One is capital preservation and the other one is capital liquidation. And I can explain what they are later. But under capital liquidation, about 90% of the people that I crunch numbers for require between 500,000 and 5 million ringgit. Under capital preservation, about 85% of people require between 3 million ringgit and 20 million ringgit. So remember earlier, I gave you a very wide range from half a mil to 20 mil. Now I'm actually segmenting it depending on the model that's being used. I will stop here. It's 3 o'clock. Maybe I'll give you a little, I'll be a little gentle. Maybe we start at 3:03. Would that be okay, Pastor David?
Yep, sure. No problem.
Wonderful. Bye, everyone. Catch you soon. 3:03.
So everyone, you can go ahead and take your break. We'll be back in another, we'll be back in 3:03. All right, so see you soon.
Okay, Pastor David, just stay unmuted for a while so that I know that everything is okay. Can you hear me? Is everything good?
Yes, all good.
Wonderful. Please let me continue. Okay, so now, as I mentioned earlier, protection, accumulation, distribution, and around the world where I've actually run programs like this, I will basically ask for a show of hands or some other response mechanism and say that if you can only work on one area, which are you most interested in? And in every group over 20 years, it's always come out as wealth accumulation. So let me talk to you about wealth accumulation. When I am taking care of the wealth accumulation side of my clients' portfolios, remember I told you when we talk about a wealth pyramid, we've got savings, investment, speculations, and gambling. I believe gambling is unwise, stupid actually. Speculations might actually be highly profitable, but there is nothing that I can do to actually help my clients consistently speculate well because I can't even do it for myself. Some of my speculations have worked out very well and others haven't. So I focus purely in the saving and investing space. When I'm building a savings and investment portfolio for clients, I use maybe 3, maybe 4, or maybe 5 full asset classes to use in a portfolio. Those are cash, fixed income, equities, investment real estate, and alternatives. Cash can be cash in your mattress or your pillowcase, cash in a piggy bank, cash in a savings account, cash in a fixed deposit account, or cash in a money market fund, a pure money market fund. Fixed income could be bonds or bond funds, could be preferred stocks or preferred securities funds. Equities can be domestic stocks or international stocks. Investment real estate can be brick and mortar rental property, or it can be listed REITs, or it could be a REIT fund. And then under alternatives, you've got a whole bunch of things like hedge funds, which are not readily available in Malaysia, but once the Singapore border reopens, things will get better. Private equity, foreign currency, structured products, maybe a couple of other things. But my favorite is actually commodities, because commodities represent the stuff of life. So when clients come to me with a reasonable amount of money, typically I will build a portfolio with, say, 4 or 5 asset classes. If it's 5, I would use international REIT funds in this space, and I would use a global commodity fund here. So I hope that's useful to you. Make a note about what you're interested in. If you look at your handout on page 7, number 9, which asset classes do you want to learn more about? So please look at this and just write down specific questions you might actually have about certain asset classes to use in a portfolio. Let me move on. Okay. I've got a handout exercise, but I don't really want to spend too much time there. So maybe I will just stop talking for 30 seconds. For those of you who have the handout, you can jot down your answers to question number 9 and especially answer the second bit. Why do you want to learn about those specific asset classes? We'll come back in 30 seconds.
Sorry, I'm quite blur. What is asset classes?
It's not a problem at all. What's your name, please? Who is this?
Zoe.
Oh, Zoe. Hi. Okay. You know how, Zoe, people talk about not putting all your eggs in one basket, that you should basically diversify your investments? You're familiar with the term, right? Don't put all your eggs in one basket, Zoe. Zoe, yes or no?
Yes, I was being muted.
Okay. Maybe it's because Pastor David wants us to deal with this later. So I won't ask you to unmute again. I'll answer this very quickly here, and then I will go deeper later, Zoe. I believe in the importance of diversifying. Don't put all your eggs in one basket. And there are three types of diversification that I recommend. Diversification by asset class, which, Zoe, is what your question is about. Diversification by geographic region, and diversification across a very long timeline. Diversification across geographic regions means don't put all your money in the US, don't put all your money in Singapore, don't put all your money in Malaysia, don't put all your money in China. Try and spread your money around the world as much as possible. Across a long timeline, let's say you have a lot of money and you want to basically invest, don't put all of it into like risky equities or maybe all in investment real estate or even all in commodities. Spread it out gradually, moving from safety to more volatile markets over a long period of time. Asset classes are these. Cash is an asset class. Fixed income is another asset class. Equities, another asset class. Investment real estate, another asset class. And alternatives, another asset class. And I didn't make this up. For those of you, Zoe included, who are interested in learning more about this, write this down in your notes. There is something called the WWR, which is the World Wealth Report. It is published every year by a wealth management company called Cap Gemini, C-A-P Gemini, G-E-M-I-N-I, Gemini. And you can get access to the World Wealth Report. It's free. You just need to go to the correct site, do a search on Capgemini World Wealth Report, download the fill in your details, and then they allow you to gain access. Download the PDF. It's maybe 50 pages. And not in every year's report, but most years' reports, there is a tabulation of where the world's best or biggest investors, the wealthiest people, maybe the wealthiest 20 to 40 million people, where they park their money. And that analysis actually follows this. Across asset classes, cash, fixed income, equities, investment, real estate, alternative investments. And so Zoe, at the risk of sounding circular, an asset class is a class of assets. It's a type of asset. And so cash is one type of asset. Bonds or preferred securities come under another type, fixed income. Stocks or stock funds, equity funds, another type. REITs or REIT funds, another type. And then the various things I mentioned to you all come under here. I'm going to keep moving very quickly.
What about your property? Is that not an asset too?
It is. It comes under investment real estate. May I continue?
Yeah.
Okay, so Zoe, just mute yourself and then reserve your questions, write them down and let Pastor David take charge of that. Okay. Now, many years ago, I actually created something called the Rajan Devadasan Blueprint for Financial Freedom. And I created it to help my clients and audiences better grasp what's required to succeed financially. It's a very, very, very simple blueprint. It's only got five moving parts. And the five elements of the blueprint are these. If you're tracking in your handout, it's on page 8. And there is a diagram there that you can look at. But I'm also going to show it to you step by step, so you don't need to worry about it. But I recommend all of you actually take a photograph of this page so that you have the five elements of the blueprint: active income, operational expenses, portfolio of debt, emergency buffer fund, and passive income. And I'm going to explain what each one is. Now, this is what the blueprint looks like. The Rajan Devadasan Blueprint for Financial Freedom. Now, the first element is active income. I'm actually picking up ambient noise. So if you're not muted, please mute yourself so I don't pick up additional noise. If everyone is muted, then I can actually speak a lot easier. Okay. So, yeah, I can still hear rustling. I don't know where it's coming from. Pastor David, can you take care of this? Okay, right. So active income is actually the money that you get from working. You turn up at work. And the harder you work and the smarter you work, the more money you make. We use our active income. This is for those who have a salary job. For those of us who are in business, then our active income really is the revenue or the profit that we generate. And actually, at this juncture, it's the revenue that we generate by being directly involved in our business. And after active income, after active income, we come across something called operational expenses. Now, our operational expenses are a reflection of our lifestyle choices, And I think many of you would probably know people who earn maybe 10,000 ringgit a month, but their operational expenses, they set their lifestyle at maybe 7,000 ringgit a month. And there are others who know people who earn 10,000 a month and they set their expenses at 10,000 a month. And you may also know people who earn 10,000 a month, but their expenses are 15,000 a month. So different strokes for different folks. There's a full gamut of people. Can I just say that in an ideal situation, you want to make sure that your active income is always or almost always bigger than your operational expenses. And so remember, operational expenses is tied only to your lifestyle choices. Because you want your active income to be bigger than your operational expenses, all of us definitely want to grow our active income. And how do we grow our active income? My advice is, if you are under the age of 35, build a reputation of being the hardest worker in your company. Work so hard, not speak loudly, but work so hard that people know that you're the kind of person who really, really gets the job done. And then as you progress in your career, definitely if you're 35 or older, you'll find that you can no longer compete with the younger graduates coming out or the younger workers there. And so in addition to working harder, you also need to work smarter. And so you want to work hard and smart. The older you get, better get smarter. And you want to grow this so that your operational expenses are less than your AI active income. And since active income is larger than operational expenses, you take the excess money and what do you do with it? You have a portfolio of debt. Almost all of us have a portfolio of debt, a collection of our debts. Those may be our car loans, our housing loan or our housing loans. We may have credit card balances that are not paid off in full. That means we're actually carrying and we have a certain amount that we must pay every month. There'll be personal loans that the banks are always trying to push down our throats. You've got monthly payments to make. Many of you may actually have gone and bought a television or a fridge or whatever using some kind of zero interest credit card thing that looks good, but actually just sucks up your cash flow. And so we all need to deal with our portfolio of debt. And there are two strategies to intelligently take care of this. And if anyone's interested, ask me questions about this and I will talk about those strategies later. Now, ideally, grow your active income, control your operational expenses, try and pay off your portfolio of debt as fast as you can. Hopefully, you still have some money left over. And that money should flow into your emergency buffer fund, EBF. If you are a conventional employee, if you're salaried, you should actually try and get between 3 and 6 months of your expenses, normal monthly expenses, in a safe emergency buffer fund. Don't use an overdraft account for this. Make sure you have real cash. And I will explain to you why. I had a very bad personal experience during the Asian financial crisis of 1997 and 1998 about using a bank overdraft, specifically with Standard Chartered Bank in Seremban, and suddenly finding out that the banks basically pull the rug from under you. So if you are a conventional employee, you need a buffer of between 3 and 6 months. I would hope I get specific questions about this. If you are self-employed like I am, or you run your own business as I do, or you own your own company as my wife and I do, then your emergency buffer fund should be between 6 and 12 months expenses. So as the money flows through here, I recommend that everything flows through here, regardless of whether your target is 3 months or 6 months or 12 months or 10 months or whatever. Make sure that everything flows here until you get to 2 months expenses. After you exceed 2 months, you can split and 50% of the excess goes here. So you continue to build your EBF, but it's slower. And then a little bit goes here. Now, because we've got active income here, many of you will already have figured out that the balancing arrow here should be for passive income. And if you thought about it, you're correct. Because what we need to do now is to create our portfolio of wealth, our collection of wealth-generating products. And some of them should generate passive income. And the passive income sources can be, it's very important, I want you to write it down. Your passive income sources can be interest from your cash savings, maybe bank savings or fixed deposits. Over here could be dividends that you get from your dividend yielding stocks or dividends that you get from EPF. So here it's interest, here it's dividends. Many of you would already have unit trust portfolios. I believe your unit trust funds probably allow you to reinvest your distributed units for more units. But when you approach retirement and you actually need real money to pay your bills, when there's no more active income flowing through, then what you should do is restructure all or part of your unit trust portfolio so that your distributions are paid out as cash into a designated bank account. This is a very large part of my work. And the last bit here has to do with rental. Precisely what Zoe said, what about property? And then I said that property for investment purposes comes under investment real estate. And so if you own property and you're collecting rent directly, that's wonderful. So it's collected rent. But if you own REITs, real estate investment trusts, then because you buy REITs in the stock market the same way that you would buy, say, Maybank or Tanaga or whatever else, and so you would be rewarded, you would get the rent, the net rental flow from your listed REITs in the form of dividends. And if you buy a listed REIT fund, for instance, for myself and for my clients, I use a couple of international REIT funds. I use one that covers the Asia Pacific, and I use one that covers the entire world. And the global one is managed out of Boston. And I get my cash from those REIT funds in the form of cash distributions. So it's very, very important. Okay, I hope this helps. Next bit is, how do you know when you actually achieve financial freedom? I'm going to invite a few of you just to unmute yourself because I would like some participation here. I'd like you just to help me. Can anyone tell me what FF stands for?
Financial freedom.
Very good, thank you. So we achieve financial freedom when our PI is greater than OE plus RPOPOD. What is PI? Anyone?
Passive income.
Again, please?
Passive income.
Very good. We achieve financial freedom when our PI, when our passive income is greater than, can anyone tell me what OE is?
Operational expenses.
Wonderful. Absolutely right. Operational expenses. So we achieve financial freedom when our passive income is greater than operational expenses plus, now this sounds a bit tricky. Can anybody tell me what RPOPOD stands for?
Return of something, something.
No, it's not. But thank you for trying. If you don't know what RPOPOD is, don't feel bad because frankly, I haven't told you. But there is a portion here that I've already covered. So is there any portion here that you want to try and identify?
PODS, portfolio of debt.
Very, very good. Who is that, please?
It's me, Daniel.
Oh, Pastor Daniel.
No, the other Daniel.
Oh, another Daniel. Okay, so non-Pastor Daniel. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
This could get really confusing because my late father's name was also Daniel. So nice to make your acquaintance, Daniel. Portfolio of debt is correct. RPO here stands for regular payments on your portfolio of debt. Regular payments on your portfolio of debt. Now, as you strive to achieve financial freedom, you will find that if you are able to eliminate your portfolio of debt, that means this bit disappears, so you don't have to worry about this anymore, then you realize that you achieve financial freedom the moment your passive income exceeds your operational expenses. Very, very simple. But this one actually stands like a, it acts like an albatross around the neck. It's a weight around the neck. And so I recommend that people actually try and get out of debt. Now, there may be during the Q&A, some of you who are saying, well, what about good debt, debt that makes me money? I'm happy to answer that question as well. Now, if you turn to your handout,
Brother Rajan, you are muted.
Sorry, how long have I been muted? What happened?
Oh, just a while. It's okay.
Okay, let me start again. Okay. So I showed you the formula. Financial freedom you achieve when your passive income exceeds operational expenses plus your regular payments on your portfolio of debt. This is the full diagram. For those of you tracking along, especially with your printed handout, go to page 8 and item number 10. And on the right-hand side where it says AI, you write active income. The rectangle right at the top, you put operational expenses. The oval in the middle of your notes, you write down portfolio of debt. The rectangle more to the left, you put emergency buffer fund or EBF. And at the end here, you basically, or at the top here, basically, you follow your notes. PI is passive income. Now, for those of you, again, following in the notes, financial freedom is the happy state of having sufficient passive income to meet all normal expenses. Now, the question I want to ask you is this something that you desire? Is achieving financial freedom something that is actually important to you? And if it is, how important a goal is it to you? So if it's not at all important, in your notes, for those of you who have printed it out, you circle not at all important. If it's moderately important, you circle moderately. If it is very important, you circle very. I'll give you 10 seconds to do it by yourself. Okay, let's continue. Now, if we take a close look, and now I'm on page 9 of your notes. If we look at Deuteronomy chapter 8. Pastor Daniel, my computer has frozen. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Right. So anyway, my computer's a bit sluggish. I'm not sure why. Okay, Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 10 to 19. Let me also get rid of myself. I don't need to look at myself. Okay. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws and his decrees that I am giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks grow large and your silver and gold increase and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud and you will forget the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through the vast and dreadful wilderness, that thirsty and waterless land with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never known, to humble and test you, so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your ancestors as it is today. If you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and worship and bow down to them, I testify against you today that you will surely be destroyed. Now, theologically, the last bit is a real problem for those of us who spend most of our time in the New Testament. But one of the ways of looking at it, and I want you basically not to take my word for this, to check it with your senior pastor, Pastor Daniel, later, or even Pastor Yvonne. But the way I look at it is, the world is a very, very tough place, and we need the protection of God. And so in a sense here, when destruction falls upon those who say they walk away from God, the way I think of it, it's almost as though God takes away, he doesn't so much cause the destruction, though I'm sure he can, but he takes away the protection. And then we're basically as vulnerable as everyone else. So that's the way I tend to think of it. But please double check with your own pastors for proper interpretation. Now, so what exactly should we do? I feel very strongly about this. Do not wait to feel humble to practice humility. Don't wait to feel humble to practice humility. I recommend that you stay humble and remember God gives us the capacity to create wealth. And even if you don't feel it, practice it. And the more that you mull over how big God is, how big the universe that he created is in contrast to our tiny solar system, our tiny, tiny planet, our tiny, tiny country, our tiny, tiny selves. If humility doesn't just wash over you, I think there would be something quite odd about it. Stay humble. How should we stay humble? In my opinion, sticking to a basic plan is very, very helpful. Very helpful. And this is the plan that I recommend. For those of you who are tracking in your notes, on page 9, at the top under number 11, jot down whatever thoughts you may have on humility. Number 12 is very simple. Who gives us the capacity to create wealth? It's actually God. And then my question to you earlier was, especially if we don't feel humble, how do we practice humility? How do we stay humble? And my answer is, I think sticking to a basic plan helps us to do so. And this is a basic plan that I created for the order, at least. I put together, probably first did it for a column that I was writing for Asian Beacon magazine many years ago. So whether you are a young child who receives just ad hoc Christmas money or birthday money or Chinese New Year money, ang paos, or whether you are an older child who receives an allowance, or whether, you know, you're a working adult and you work and you receive a salary, or you've got business income that sometimes trickles in and sometimes pours in, as the money comes in, regardless of what it is, as it flows through, the first thing you should do is tithe. The second thing you should do is save and invest. The third thing you should do is give. And the fourth thing you should do is to actually spend. And this includes money that you use to live on. It includes your taxes. It includes your debt repayments. If you look at your notes, for those of you who have them, bottom of page 9, going across to the top of page 10. Number 13, if we understand the importance of flow and storage in planning our finances well, how should we prioritize the allocation of every ringgit that flows through our lives? This four-tiered priority list can change your life if you let it. Now, the tithe is basic, it's 10%. But for tiers 2, 3, and 4, since this is 10%, these must add up to 90%. But it's really up to you how you want to make those work. My recommendation is tier 1 for tithing. Now, these verses here and the verses that I have associated with each of the other tiers, I'm giving you the references. I actually have the references here so I can refer to them very quickly if there are questions later. But I won't be spending time reading everything. So please take a picture so that you have all the references. So tithing, we tithe 10%. Whether you choose to tithe 10% of net or 10% of gross, I don't really mind. It's between you and God. For myself, a long time ago, I decided that I would much rather have gross blessing than net blessing. So I try my best to actually tithe on gross. Gets a little tricky sometimes because my business income comes in from different places. So check out Proverbs 3, 9 to 10 and Malachi 3, 10. The second bit is saving and investing. Now this actually surprises some Christians sometimes because they say, well, shouldn't I be giving my offering to church first before I save and invest? And I would say no. Because Jesus said, it is better to give than to receive. But we cannot give that which we do not have. And if we can't give what we don't have, then we need to make sure that we have. And the way to have is to first, after you've taken care of your tithe, save and invest. Now, the percentage to save and invest, my recommendation is, if you've never saved before, start small. If your salary is, say, 3,000 ringgit a month, and you've never saved before consistently, I urge you to start at 1%. Can you set aside 30 ringgit out of 3,000? Most people can. And what you will find is, and this is not in the notes, but I have found that this actually works very, very well, very, very often. It basically is that there's a principle at work, and the principle is, money saved, which also covers invest, okay? So money saved, meaning money saved and invested. Money saved acts as a magnet for money earned. Imagine this is a piece of metal and this is a magnet. You put them together, they'll be drawn. Money saved acts as a magnet for money earned. And as you begin to set money aside, it's almost as though God sees that you started to become serious and he blesses you even more. And on top of that, remember the Malachi chapter 3 promises associated with tithing. Okay, so as God blesses you, increase your saving and investing proportion from 1 to maybe 2 to maybe 5 to maybe 15 to maybe 20, but don't go beyond 50. Don't become a hoarder. I recommend a maximum savings rate of 50%. Tier 3, it's giving. And please take a picture so you have the Bible references here. Luke 6:38, 2 Corinthians 9, 6 to 8, Proverbs 11, 24 to 25. This giving, for Christians in particular, encompasses your love offerings, not your tithe. Your tithe was given first, but your regular love offerings, your mission pledges, your building pledges, you're giving to Christian charities, you're giving to secular charities. Maybe you just want to, you know, when things open up, you can actually walk around. Maybe you always have money in your pocket so that you can be generous and it's an allocated amount. And then you see a beggar or you see someone who needs help, you can give the money. And this percentage, I recommend we start, maybe, especially if you don't have much money, you start low. But as God blesses you, maybe consider taking it all the way up to 88%. Now, this can maybe blow your mind. Bear with me. Normally, I do this through a series of discussion points with my groups, but because we're short of time, I'll just take you through the points. First question that I tend to ask is it possible to live well in Malaysia if you earn 100,000 ringgit a year? And most people will tell me, yes, it's possible to live well in Malaysia if you earn 100,000 ringgit a year. My next question is, then is it possible to live very, very well on 1 million ringgit a year? And almost everyone will say yes. Then my third question is, well, are there people in Malaysia who earn more than 100 million ringgit per year? And the answer definitely is yes. May not be you, definitely is not me, may not be anyone you know, but people you know of. And not just the tycoons, even the mini tycoons are pretty much at that level. So if you're earning 100 million a year, and after giving, we go to spending. And you can see that it comes down to 1% here. If we spend 1 million or just 1% on ourselves, we can actually give 88 million out of the 100 million in terms of giving. This would have to be net income because your taxes will whack 30%, between 25 and 30%, depending on how you structure it. As an individual or through a business or a company. So here, giving is very, very important and you should structure it. The last bit is spending. Now, even though it's the last bit, because most people here, you know, whether you're earning 2,000 or 5,000 or 10,000, most people are finding it difficult. And so therefore, you tend to basically spend the bulk of your money, which is why I actually started this at the high end. Percentage to spend or live on. I recommend you start at 88%, and gradually, as God blesses you and you get more and more, you may spend more, but the percentage drops. And if you ever get to the point where you live on only 1 million a year, but you're bringing in 100 million, you can manage this. You'd have to start at a high percentage early in life because we generally earn less early than we do later in life. And please check Romans 13, 7 to 8. On page 10 in the notes, I have the reference, John 10:10, King James Version. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. Jesus loves us and he wants to give us far more and far more often than we want to receive from him. We just need to get our act together and get the structure right and figure out a way to incrementally put him first in our lives. Now, if you look at page 10, number 14, if you use this four-tiered CFAP or cash flow allocation plan to structure your finances, what might it look like? So let me give you an example. If you're a student who receives maybe 100 ringgit a week or 100 ringgit a month, depending on the type of student, your tithe is 10%, so it's 10 ringgit here. You may decide that you want to save and invest 10 ringgit. You may want to give 10 ringgit and you've got 70 ringgit to spend on yourself. You're a student with very little money. If you're an adult and you're earning 2,000 ringgit a month, your tithe will be 200. Maybe you should try and save and invest 150. Give maybe 50 ringgit and you've got 1,006 to live on. If you're an adult earning more money, your tithe still 10%, 500 ringgit. Now you can actually save and invest more, maybe 800 ringgit. You can give more, maybe 200 ringgit. And your quality of life goes up. You can spend 3,500 ringgit. You become an adult earning 10,000 ringgit. Your tithe is still 10%, 1,000 ringgit. Maybe you save and invest 2,500 every month. You can give 500 ringgit. You can spend 6,000. So it's fully scalable. Wherever you may be, especially if you got your printed handout, I recommend that you put your own numbers down. That's why it says, if you use this four-tier CFAP or cash flow allocation plan to structure your finances, what might it look like? So under monthly income, put your own monthly income, gross or net, but make sure you have adjustments. Put your tithe. Now, if you tithe on net, put your net income. If you tithe on gross, put your gross tithe under tithe. then remember under spending, you got to add the taxes. If you're not sure about that, ask me during Q&A. Okay, so this handout exercise that I've talked about, I've already talked you through it. You're welcome to ask me questions a little bit later. We're almost done. We're going to wrap up very quickly. Now, in your handout, and I really hope that all of you are looking at it either on another device or printed, on page 11, wrap up. To move forward, you might opt to take a DIY route or to seek professional help. So I will guide you through these. I will guide you through these slides. I'm going to, I think I'll guide you through some slides and then I will unmute and we'll have some revision. So give me a minute. Now, for those of you who said that, you know, it's quite important for you to achieve financial freedom, you may wish to work with a licensed financial planner. Most of you, I assume, are in KL. I noticed that someone was joining us from Melbourne. So, hi. There may be others who are coming in from all over the world. Individuals who are physically based in Malaysia can use this resource to identify professionals who are physically near you. So, if you're in KL, you may want to do a search for PJ and KL. If you're in Sabah, maybe you do a search for Kota Kinabalu. If you're in Sarawak, maybe you do a search for Kuching, that kind of thing. So take a picture of this. It's a very, very useful website. Give you an example of how it works. Now look at this. Huh? This is HTTPS. So once you put it in, you see you get a lock here, smartfinance/planners. Now this was done just as a test. I have no idea where Jinjarum is. I typed in Klang and for some reason this came up. But you notice these are the licensed financial planners in Malaysia in Klang. Jennifer Klang, Tan Hui Chi Klang, Ocean Pon Klang, Ng Klang and Angie Ng Klang. Just for example, if you were to type in Seremban, then you would get me. Now that's in case you want to work with a pro. On a DIY basis, do-it-yourself basis, you may find it useful. I actually write the weekly financial planning column for the Sunday Times. And if you go to this website, I've been doing it for almost 6 years, I think. So there are more than 300 columns there. If you just go here, you've got free access to, I don't know whether it's all the columns, but it looks like a lot. So it's either all or a lot of them. So I hope you find those helpful. What else can I give you? Okay, so what will you do with what you've learned today? I think I'll take it all the way to the end. And during the Q&A, as you guys are getting ready, I will ask you the revision questions. What will you do with what you've learned today? What will you do? So maybe I'll give you 1 minute. With your handout, you look at pages 11 and 12. And my questions are, what is the one thing Christians would be wise to do when they manage their money? I've already taught you this. Do you remember? If so, write it down. What are the two financial statements that help us manage our money wisely for a brighter future? We've covered it. What are the three parts of a complete personal financial plan? We've covered it. What are the 3, 4, or 5 asset classes to use when constructing your own wealth accumulation portfolio? And what will you do with what you learned today? If you've got your handout, I'll give you 30 seconds to jot down some answers. Okay, if you're not sure, I think, no, not even that. I will definitely give you the answers to all of this in a while. Let's just wrap up. I've had fun with you. The next time I run, and this is all secular stuff, okay, not Christian financial plan. The next time I run a secular online webinar, this one happens to be free. it's called the ABCs of Financial Planning with Rajan Devadasan, will be on Monday night, August 2nd. You're welcome to join me if you like. I'll give you the link later. I'm also going to be running another one, which would normally appeal to slightly older people. This is called Rajan's Building Blocks of Retirement. And that will be on Monday, September 6th. So you're welcome to sign up for that. It's not one or the other. You're welcome to sign up for both if you like. Those two are free. This one is not. This one costs $70 US. So it's a bit pricey for most people. But that's where I do a deep dive into the Rajan Devadasan Blueprint for Financial Freedom. And I'm doing it on Malaysia Day, the night of Malaysia Day. Okay, so now you may want to take a picture of this. If you or your friends are keen to check out free resources or to attend any of the webinars, the free or premium ones, you may sign up here. Take a picture of that if you want. And for specific video invitations, in case you know you thought it'd be helpful and you want to just send it out to your friends who may want to know things about the ABC webinar or retirement webinar, I've actually gone to the studio and I've recorded a video invite. So you're welcome to send them here and here. Just take a picture. Okay, I am done. We go straight to questions. I'm going to stop the share. Pastor Daniel, can you unmute yourself? I need to ask you something.
Yes.
Pastor Daniel, it's now almost 3:51. And I've actually cleared more time for you. And I want to just be able to make sure that I respect your time. So I think we can do a hard stop at 4 o'clock, but I am happy to keep answering questions at least till 4:15, maybe even 4:30, if the internet continues. So it's really up to you. So is that okay with you?
I'm okay with that. We are so grateful that you can extend. I believe because those who wants to go off, they can go off if they need to. But you are the main man that we need to. If you are available, we will keep you here.
I am available. As long as Telecom doesn't kill us. If they do, then I'll use Maxis. Pastor David, would you unmute, please?
Yes.
May I, as you collate your questions, I want to just very quickly give people the answers to the review questions. So I'll just speak and then they can jot down. Then I'll leave you completely in charge. You can outline the questions and I'll answer whatever I can. But please be cognizant of the time. And at 4 p.m. sharp, can you, maybe 3:59 p.m. sharp, you stop us. And then maybe Pastor Daniel, I can ask you to close us in prayer. So those who have to go can be covered in prayer. And then we can continue for those who want to stay. Would that be all right?
Okay. I will be handling the Q&A now.
Oh, you are? Okay.
We have collated all the questions. There are quite a number of them, but some of them are overlapping, so we have compiled them so into block questions, each of them.
Good, good. So basically, if you're taking care of that, I'll let Pastor David be my timekeeper. So Pastor David, at 3:59 or 4 o'clock, please interrupt me, stop me, and then Pastor Daniel can pray, and then we can let people go, and then those who want to stay. Oh, wow. I thought we had 40 people. Now you've got 84. That's pretty cool. Well done. Okay. Okay. So now for those of you who are tracking with your notes, I'll just take 1 minute with this. On pages 11 and 12, revision. What is the one thing Christians would be wise to do when managing their money? Exercise delayed gratification. Exercise delayed gratification. It's got nothing to do with Christians or not. Anybody who wants to manage his money well, her money well, you must exercise delayed gratification. And delayed gratification doesn't mean giving up bad things for good. Very often it means giving up good things so that down the road you can have something great. Okay, what are the two financial statements that help us manage our money wisely for a brighter future? Your net worth statement and your cash flow statement. Next page, on page 12. What are the three parts of a complete personal financial plan? Wealth protection, wealth accumulation, and wealth distribution. Next bit, what are the three or four or five asset classes to use when constructing your wealth accumulation portfolio? Cash, fixed income, equities, investment real estate, alternatives. And with alternatives, I generally tend to use commodities. And the last bit, what will you do with what you learned today? I cannot answer that. You guys are going to have to answer it yourself. Again, if you're just tracking with the handout, on page 13 is a gift from me to you. It's an appendix of 26 book titles. An appendix of 26 book titles covering financial planning, investing, business, and economics, and a range from very, very simple to very, very complex. So it's printed out. If you want a PDF version, there's a link at the bottom, one of my websites, freecoolarticles.com/giftcenter. It's there. And then the last two pages, just information about me. So that's fine. I've got the Bible verses that I reference for the four-tiered structure, so we can talk about it. I am done. Thank you. I wish all of you a very, very good, especially near-term future, navigating the uncertainties of this pandemic. And I pray that just as I am certain the pandemic will pass, like every other crisis we have gone through, this will pass. But I pray and hope that based on what you have learned, you'll be able to go through this. And then as things recover, I really hope that before the next crisis hits us, and I guarantee you there will be a next crisis, you will actually be well positioned to take advantage of that next crisis and to emerge, assuming Jesus tarries, to emerge much stronger. So thank you and God bless you.
All right. Thank you so much, Brother Rajan. You have shared so much information to each one of us today. I believe we can learn so much. Probably we might need to get you again to cover more specific topics.
But I'd be happy to come, hopefully in person.
Oh, that would be great. Yes. For now, let me just give you some question. The first one is, where should we put our money for short-term and long-term savings with minimum risk and high liquidity?
Oh, minimum risk, high liquidity, short-term. Whether it's, because you're talking about savings and you're talking about minimum risk, then whether it's short-term or long-term, the answer is exactly the same. Because usually what happens is the advantage of a long-term period is that you can actually shift some of your money from pure savings to investments. And if you have the correct mindset, maybe even into speculation. But the bottom line is, I would say, Pastor Daniel, as far as you know, I assume everyone who's here is a Christian, okay? So I'm just going to work on that assumption until you tell me otherwise. Do you have Christian Bumiputras in this group? Maybe East Malaysians?
I don't think so.
Yeah. Okay. If that's the case, I'm not going to say anything. But for those of you who are listening, if you know that you've got Christian Bumiputras, you could suggest that they also use ASB or ASB2. Very specifically, not ASN, not anything else, but within the PNB structure, Permodalan Nasional Berhad, ASB1 and ASB2. Now, for regular people, non-Bumis, non-Malays, Christians, I would say basically to answer that specific question, bank savings, fixed deposits, and pure money market funds. That's all that I would use. Next question.
Okay. In this season, is it a good idea to settle our housing loan or to use the money for investment?
It's a very good point. Do you remember when I actually gave the formula for financial freedom? I said basically that you will achieve financial freedom when your passive income is greater than your operational expenses plus your RPO-POD, greater than your regular payment on your portfolio of debt. Now, every time we pay down a debt, we actually de-risk our lives. And many people, particularly prior to March 18th, 2020 in Malaysia, were basically working on the assumption that, there's a difference between bad debt and good debt. Because bad debt makes you poorer. Maybe you just spend it on cars or whatever else. And good debt, let's say you go buy a house and you rent it out, and hopefully it makes you money. So there's a difference. But when the crisis hit, many people suddenly found out that their tenants lost their jobs. And what started off as good debt became bad debt. So I can't just answer that question, but I will say this. If a person has sufficient cash so that you can actually pay off your housing loan in full, but before that, your emergency buffer fund is fully funded, depending on your circumstances, whether you need a 3-month buffer or a 6-month buffer or 9-month buffer or 12-month buffer, whatever your requirements are, work that out. And that may be, you know, to figure it out, I can help. If you've got the time, I can listen to someone and I can actually just ask questions and work it out. But once your buffer is fully covered, assuming that you still have a job, that means you've got money coming in and you can replenish, then I would say pay off your loan. Even though it's a very, very cheap loan, and even though there are lots of investment opportunities, we don't know just how long this crisis is going to last. But a lot of people will say, no, maybe I want to just pay down some of my loan, restructure it so that the cash flow is less, and then I want to invest. If you want to do that, that's perfectly all right. But since you asked me for my answer, I would say that if you de-leverage and you de-risk, you may actually end up in quite good shape. Okay. Next question.
Wonderful. What class of asset is unit trust? Is it wise to go into cryptocurrency in the current economic climate, or in Forex, or in physical gold or silver?
It's too many questions. Can we do one at a time?
Okay. What class of asset is unit trust?
Unit trusts are not an asset class. Please write this down. I actually have to teach this. And 21 years ago, I actually wrote, I co-wrote a book on this. So unit trusts are not an asset class. Unit trusts, take down notes. If you're interested, take down notes. Unit trusts are actually a delivery mechanism. Unit trusts are actually a delivery mechanism for various asset classes. For instance, remember I covered the five asset classes that I construct. I talked about cash. I talked about fixed income, which can be bonds, can be preferred securities. I talked about equities that can be domestic equities, international equities. I talked about investment real estate, and I talked about alternatives, meaning commodities. When I put my clients into a unit trust portfolio and they want, say, five asset classes, for cash, I put them in money market. But I also tell them, make sure that you have money in the bank. And I actually recommend people keep some money in EPF as well. When it comes to fixed income, I would use a bond fund and I would use a preferred securities fund. When it comes to equities, I would use a Malaysian equity fund, and maybe a US equity fund, and maybe a regional equity fund, and maybe a Chinese equity fund, and whatever else. When it comes to investment real estate, I actually only use international stuff, which would be throughout the Asia Pacific and globally. And then I told you commodities, and that one I use I use a global commodities fund. Now, Pastor Daniel, before you say anything, there was a question that just popped out, and I want to answer this. The question was, can I please repeat the three types of diversification? So I want to just answer it so whoever wants can write it down. I recommend don't put all your eggs in one basket. It's already 402. Diversify across asset classes. I've covered the different asset classes. Diversify across geographic regions, and diversify across a long timeline. Pastor Daniel, can we stop? Can you just close us in prayer so people can go, and then I'll just answer whatever else?
All right, sure. Amen. Father, we want to thank you for this time, for this sharing to us, which is so beneficial and has opened our eyes to so many things to help us to be wise, to plan ahead, to be prepared. Because we will never know the future. But God, with wise planning, with your guidance, Lord, we can protect each one of us and we can go through it at least without so much stress and concern about financial matters. We thank you for this sharing. We thank you for what Brother Rajan has shared with us. I pray for every participant that we have learned something, we have gleaned something, and we will follow the biblical principle. And we know, God, we can always depend on you. And we can always come to you, O Lord. Thank you, Jesus. May your blessings and your protection go with all of us. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. So for those of you who are going, thank you so much. It's been a delight spending time with you. God bless you. And for those who are staying, let's have some fun. So Pastor Daniel, what's your next question?
Okay. The next one is it wise to go into cryptocurrency during this current climate, economic climate, or maybe Forex or physical gold?
Okay. I go back to diversify across 3, 4, or 5 asset classes. I mentioned the fifth asset class that I would put people into, which is alternative investments. And I use a global commodity fund. I also have a gold account. So I'm very comfortable with gold, particularly if you buy at a regular point. Now, I am 57 years old. I'm a real dinosaur, and I will give you a dinosaur type answer. I am super distrustful of crypto. I hate crypto. Okay, I hope I'm very clear. I hate crypto. And when we go through a situation where, let's say, Bitcoin's price goes from $5,000, $10,000 to $20,000, then I look like I've got egg on my face. And then when it collapses, I try not to be petty and say, I told you so. But that's what I'm thinking at the back of my mind. And then when crypto goes from when Bitcoin goes to $30,000, $40,000, $50,000, $60,000, again, increasingly egg on my face. When it collapses, I try not to say, I told you so. But I don't trust crypto. And let me explain why. When you look at the development of human society and the way that money has actually been transformed over time, you realize that in the old days, out of Eden, okay, it would basically be a case of barter. So let's say I've got a whole bunch of apples and you've got some pears, and then we do a swap. Or I go fishing and I have a bunch of ikan kembung, and you raise puppies, and let's say people in my family actually want a pet. So we do a trade. So barter, you basically barter stuff. But as human society got more and more complex, the need for money arose. And the first type of money was actually commodity money. Commodity money was coin form and usually silver or gold coins. So the money itself had value, silver and gold. Then the next thing that happened was, because more and more people came, more and more activities, and there simply wasn't enough, or it wasn't safe to carry around so much silver and gold. I think it was the Chinese who actually invented paper money. The paper money basically would have been piece of paper signed by some big shot. And it says, if you bring this piece of paper to our central bank, whatever the equivalent was, we'll give you a few pounds of silver or we'll give you a few ounces of gold. And so things are not developing. And, oh, hang on a minute, Pastor Yvonne, I saw that you're not accepting any more questions. Just for anyone who's got a question but can't get it through, it's okay. Download and print the handout. On the very first page of the handout, you have my contact details. Drop me an email. Just tell me you're in Canaan Church. Ask your question. I don't know all the answers, but I'm happy to try and answer directly. So no one should be left out, okay? But right now, coming back to representative money. So it became too dangerous. People were robbing each other. So you have the paper. And then you take the piece of paper, and then you get your silver and gold. But again, human society grew and the level of complexity grew. And then fairly recently, in March 1971, when President Richard Nixon was still president of the US, he broke the gold standard. Previously, it was a case of for every ounce of pure gold, you would get $35. And foreigners were actually taking advantage of this, and they were siphoning out, they were giving the US back its dollars and taking its gold. And finally, Nixon said, enough is enough. This is before Watergate and before he was impeached. Yeah. And so in the case of that break that Nixon did, it ended representative money. And what we ended up with was fiat money, F-I-A-T, fiat money. Now, fiat money has got nothing to do with Italian cars. Fiat money means this. The currency is utterly useless. It is only, the only value is that it is backed by the trust people have in a particular government. So right now, you know that the ringgit is weakening, and it's not too surprising because the level of trust in this unelected, incompetent, largely kleptocratic government is not high. If you want to follow me on Twitter or you want to connect with me on LinkedIn, I can sound a lot harsher than that. I am angry, and it's just tragic that I'm actually having more and more conversations with my clients who have got children, and I'm telling them, look, it really looks that barring God giving us a miracle that is perhaps even larger than what we saw in March 2018, Malaysia will become not just a failed state, but Malaysia will become a failed Islamic state. And I started being very clear about the timing last year. And last year I was saying in 20 years. So if I'm going to be consistent, I would say by 2040. But God can work. And I'm so glad that the best young people that we have, not everyone is leaving. Some of them are intent on staying here. And as long as they do, maybe there is hope. But I am having these conversations with my clients, telling them, look, I understand if you actually want to move a portion of your retirement fund into your kids' tertiary education fund so that you give your children a chance to go overseas, maybe build a platform, a footprint out there so that not necessarily they have to leave, but if things really go bad, at least they have an option. Okay, so coming back to fiat, Malaysian fiat, not great. US dollar, even though they keep printing more and more of it, you know, it's still there. So the reason that I am distrustful of private crypto is this. The value of fiat currency is nothing other than confidence in the issuing government. I really have to ask you, do you think the US, do you think China, do you think Japan, do you think the UK, do you think Australia, do you think Malaysia, do you think Singapore, do you think all these countries are just going to sit by and let some people with high-powered computers come and usurp the power of the governments to actually issue fiat currency? And when Bitcoin was very, very cheap years ago, I already was basically saying, I don't trust it. And so that's my position. Considering the price of Bitcoin right now, it looks, at least at this juncture, that I am wrong. But whatever it is, my position has not changed. So I will not recommend crypto. Pastor Daniel, there was more to your question.
Yes. All right.
Yes. Pastor Daniel, you're muted. I can't hear you.
Yes. All right. Okay. Now let's go to the next one. How can I improve my financial IQ? Please share some tips on investment and philosophy. How much saving do you think is adequate for a middle-aged person around 50?
Okay. I'll answer this one step at a time. The first question was, how do I improve my financial IQ? I believe that was a question.
Yep. I think this is for a person who is around 50, approaching retirement, right?
It doesn't matter. For that question, it doesn't matter what the age is. That's why I actually put my appendix in. Go to page 13 of my handout and look at Rajan Devadasan's graded reading list for DIY learners of financial planning. As I told you, there are 26 books there. I put this list back together, put it together many, many years ago, and quite difficult to get many of the books now, but no problems. Basically, the question is, the answer is this. Start with the list, whatever books you can get, start at the top, work your way down, and read, and then attend. Attend webinars like this, workshops, seminars, talk to people. That is the way you do it. And then be very, very careful about the money that you want to put into any investment or any speculation, because you have spent years, you have spent decades earning that money. Don't spend 20 years earning that money and then 20 minutes because someone, who basically speaks with a golden tongue is able to convince you to part with your money. You better make sure you can understand exactly what you're putting your money into. So be cautious. What's the next part of the question, please?
Share some tips on investment philosophy and how much do you need to save for a person of middle age, about 50?
Okay. So the best investment advice I know is basically buy low and sell high. Buy low and sell high. The problem is God doesn't ring a bell and tell us when the market is low and when the market is high. He doesn't. So there are two strategies that allow us to actually structure we structure a program of investing that actually takes away the emotions from our actions. Those two strategies are dollar cost averaging and value cost averaging. Dollar cost averaging and value cost averaging. Now, if I remember correctly, in my handout on page 13, right at the bottom is a link. It's the freecoolarticles.com/giftcenter.htm link. If you go to the Gift Center, I was just telling people you want to download the free ebook, 26 books to take you all the way to the top. But there are quite a few other free things there. You can help yourself to whatever you want. But there is a special report that I wrote many years ago that explains the difference between dollar cost averaging and value cost averaging. I won't go into the answers right now, but value cost averaging, if you do it exactly right, will give you a slightly better yield. But I actually prefer dollar cost averaging because it's literally something that you can put on autopilot and you'll basically be in good shape. So I hope that helps. And then the question is, how much money should we have at age 50?
Yeah, for adequate for savings.
Okay, I guess it really depends. If you're 50 and you plan to retire at the age of 51, then it's different. If you're 50 and you plan to retire at 60, then it's different. I'm 57. I love my work, but I have taken many, many years to get to the point where I do love my work. And so, God willing, I have a target retirement age of 75. Wow. Now, you must understand that when I look at both sides of my family, I suffer from what's known as longevity risk. Now, I don't even know whether I have one additional day. That's the truth. None of us knows for sure. But if you look at family history and the law of large numbers, statistically speaking, there's a very high probability that I will live to be 90, 90 plus and cross 100, etc. So I don't know. It's really up to God. But I love my work. And so as long as I'm functional, my target retirement age is 75. So do you remember, I also said that people want to retire at different stages. And I said that about 85-90% of the people that I crunch numbers for, at retirement, they require between 500,000 and 20 million ringgit. So if the average amount that they actually need for retirement is, say, 2 million ringgit, I'm just assuming, if it's 2 million ringgit and they say are 10 years away from retirement, then I think at age 50, you're probably looking at 75, maybe a minimum of 750,000 ringgit, including the money that you have in EPF. Also, Pastor David, just have a look. Someone called SD is asking for the note. Someone who just came in. So just make sure everyone has access to it. Okay. Pastor Daniel? Sorry, you're muted again.
Not retirement age. Money that one should have in their 50s for them to retire. Okay, so I guess you've answered that now, right?
I have answered it. I have answered it. I'm not sure right. What the problem is.
Yeah. Okay. I know a lot of us are earners. So we are not like business, running our own personal business. So these are I think majority of us are in that category. So what do you suggest for us? Because we can't be like you to retire at 75, right? So our corporation, our office will retire us whether we like it or not. Then what should we do? What should we plan then?
It's actually going to be a real problem. Your friend, my friend, the late Pastor Lim Yu Chuen.
Yes.
He and I had discussions on this a long, long time ago. He kept telling me, no point talking about financial planning. I got no finances to plan. And I asked Pastor Lim, what's your retirement plan? He said, no retirement plan. Die on the pulpit. Keep preaching. And he was business manager of BCM at the time. And so it was tragic the way that we lost him. The accident that occurred after a Bursay rally, he was knocked off his bike and then he was in ICU and then eventually he passed away.
Yeah.
So I tried my best to try and help Pastor Oilin and Lionel. Leon, I don't know as well. But the truth of the matter is that maybe not so much your generation, Pastor Daniel, but the pastors slightly older than you, there was no retirement plan. And in fact, I believe many of the churches didn't even pay EPF for a very, very long time. Whereas at your age or younger, I think basically it's pretty good. But thankfully, unless you're in a very odd church situation, I don't think it's necessarily there. You've got to stop at the age of 60. Now, one of the key points that I actually bring up in the Rajan's Building Blocks of Retirement webinar is that the biggest risk in retirement is something called longevity risk. Now, longevity risk means that we will live so long that our money runs out. So if you're talking about a regular wage earner who must stop work at age 60, then unless there is a way to get, for normal people, not super wealthy people, normal people, I really think it's very important to figure out a way to get an additional job post regular retirement. When you and I, Pastor Daniel, we're almost the same age. No? Yes. I believe I'm older than you.
Just 1 year.
I'm 1 year older than you, correct? Yeah. So when we were small, I mean, we didn't even think about it. What was the standard retirement age for us?
Oh, it was 55.
Absolutely. 55. Indoctrinated from childhood, all the conversations we heard adults, and then we were so young, we thought 55 so long ago, so long to come, such a long time to come that, you know, it'll be fine. And then you find that as you go from 25 to 35 to 45, then you realize maybe 55 a bit young. So some research I did not too long ago found out that while it's very wise for Malaysia to shift the retirement retirement age, in the public sector, what we did was we went from 55 to 56 to 58 to 60. Once the public sector had done all those stages and gone to 60, the private sector did one jump, 55 to 60. And yet, Pastor Daniel, at what age are we allowed to take, at what ages are we allowed to take money out from EPF?
55,
right? We're actually allowed to take money at 50. We're definitely allowed to take bulk at 55. And then we also, whatever we earn between 55 and 60, we can take out at 60. But do you know why, even though the official retirement age in Malaysia is 60, we're still allowed to take the bulk at 55? Do you know why?
Wow. I'm not too sure.
The answer is political. Particularly during Najib's years, it was so clear that people were getting more and more angry that they were saying that if they stop us from taking our money, it's because then all kinds of, you know, governments taking our money, et cetera, et cetera. And because of the political reasons, they never made that change. Whereas in Singapore, the PAP is so solid, PAP doesn't really care. It'll just do what needs to be done.
Right.
Now, I've done research for other pieces of writing. The official retirement age right now in most countries that have a retirement age is between 62 and 68. During the global financial crisis of late 2007, but really we felt it in 2008, 2009, Americans who had actually been doing everything right, you know, their equivalent of these programs, things called like the 401k, et cetera, the market values just got crushed. And those who actually put their 401ks not in funds, where at least it was diversified, but they put into their employer's stock, which is insane. Because you think about it, your employer pays your salary. And then you put it into your employer's stock. And can you imagine what happened to the employees of Enron who put all their money into Enron stock? Now, for those of you who don't know, Enron basically blew up. All kinds of scandals going on. So it's really important that you diversify. And I was basically recommending diversification across three dimensions. Diversify across asset classes, diversify across geographic regions, and diversify across a long timeline. I suggested that people learn about dollar cost averaging and value cost averaging. Value cost averaging and dollar cost averaging will help you invest over a long timeline. Geographic regions try and spread across the world as much as you possibly can. And in terms, hang on, is that Constance? I want to answer Constance's question. And in terms of asset classes, it's just common sense. Okay, now Constance's question was, why am I anti-crypto? I think I've already answered that. So if she just came in, others can explain it to her, her friends. But she did bring up a very good point, and that's digital currency. I'm not against digital currency. I'm not against a digital form of the US dollar or the euro or the yen or ringgit or whatever else. I'm for it. It's just another form. The bulk of our money is already digital. You know, it's not physical paper. It's actually just electrons and photons moving through the system. I'm not against it at all. But crypto, I'm highly distrustful. And I may be completely wrong. And for those of you who, and I seem to be getting a lot of these crypto things now. So let me just say this. If you're convinced that I'm a dinosaur old fogey, and you wish to go into crypto, all the best. But if you think that I know what I'm talking about, but you're still interested, Zoe, I'm sure you're not a dinosaur. If you're still interested in crypto, then listen to what I, well, try and remember what I said earlier. When it comes to managing your wealth, we've got savings, we've got investments, we've... Zoe is a baby dino. Okay. Savings, investments, and then we've got speculations and gambling. The people who don't know anything about crypto, Mei Ping, yes, we should invest abroad. Oh, or at least invest so that in Malaysia, but overseas. The people who go into crypto not knowing anything at all, they are gambling. Please know that you're gambling. And those of you who feel that, you know, you want to do traditional investing, but you think crypto maybe has a real future, then maybe what you do is you speculate. And there is an intelligent way to do that. So Pastor Daniel, you have to stop me here now, because what I'm going to say may actually be counter to what you say on the pulpit. So I'm going to just say it, but you stop me immediately. For when I teach in a secular setting and I tell people, you should be wise, you should save, you should invest, you should... okay, that's all I will recommend. But if you want to speculate or gamble, this is the way to do it so you don't blow up your family's future. You have a pyramid. And let's say you got 10 million ringgit. If you're going to gamble, I recommend that you set aside no more than 1%. Now, if you've got 10 million ringgit, 1% is 100,000 ringgit. That's quite a lot of money. But what if you don't have 10 million ringgit? What if all you have is 50,000 ringgit? You can still use the pyramid, but if you want to gamble, then your 50,000 ringgit, 1% of that is 500 ringgit. You want to be unwise enough to go and blow 500 ringgit on your gambling, so be it, but I guarantee, well, I'm almost guaranteed that you will lose it all. When you do, don't replenish. Learn your lesson. See, I'm very careful about this because I know that gambling is unwise, but I've actually had the conversation with a wife of a guy who won 10 million ringgit in the lottery. So, I mean, I've had this conversation and I had to, because, you know, there's always this tension because she was actually trying to ask whether I could help, etc. And then it's a case of, you know, do I just say, oh, 10 million sounds good. Yes, I can definitely help. Or do I actually say, can I actually say that, I actually think gambling is very, very stupid. It's unwise. And so I said it was very stupid. It was very unwise. And I never got the business. But whatever it is, if you use that, it's 1% for gambling. It's 9 percentage points for speculation. If you don't gamble and you speculate, then it's 10%. So let's say you got about 300,000 ringgit and you actually want to speculate. You understand a bit, so you don't think you're gambling. You actually want to intelligently speculate in crypto. So you don't gamble, you're not wasting that 1 percentage point. So that 1% can go to speculations. So then you can allocate, if you want to be wise, I would say allocate 90% for saving and investing and only 10% for speculations, not just crypto speculation, but all your other speculations. And for someone who's got a million ringgit, that 10% would be 100,000 ringgit. And if your speculations work very well and your 100,000 becomes 150,000, what you do is you maintain the percentages. Look at the overall savings, investment, speculation value. And if you've made money in speculations, you force the excess money down to saving and investing. For instance, if you had bought, if you're following my program and you had actually bought Bitcoin at 25,000 dollars and it went all the way up to 60, you take your profit, force it down. So I hope that helps. Pastor Daniel, I'm sure there are other questions, but it's now, I'm actually still okay. You know, if you want, I'm happy to go to 4:45 or we can stop at 4:30. I am good. And
you're good.
Unify has not died yet.
Okay, that's good.
And we still got 73 people. So yes, it's really your call.
They're staying on, right? And I have a few more questions here.
Sure, please go ahead.
Okay, these are, I think, more specifics. Are robo-investors like StashAway safe and reliable in building passive income?
StashAway has a very, very good reputation. And I think whether it's robo-advisors or robo-investors, it's basically a new age. And if you want to experiment, I recommend that you do. Try it out. But whether it's a reliable form of passive income, I'd say no. Passive income flows out not from the advisor, not from the system. Passive income flows out from the assets that you have. Now, the system may put you into the asset, but the passive income comes from the assets. What are the passive income sources? I already told you. When I was explaining the Rajan Devadasan Blueprint for Financial Freedom, I talked about active income. Grow it as much as you can. Control your operational expenses by sacrificing some things, exercising delayed gratification. Be intelligent about killing your debts. Build your emergency buffer, and then build your portfolio of wealth. Now, when people are old and very much retired, almost all of their money should come from all of their retirement money needs to be passive income. But you got a lot of young people here as well. Pastor Yvonne is very strict now. Okay.
Following and writing down all the questions.
Hang on, let's come back to passive income. When it comes to passive income, what you want to do is you focus on the assets. And so I like having cash. I do. I've got a lot of money in fixed deposits and savings, etc. I like having cash, but I don't keep the bulk of my money there because the yields are very bad. But I have some, which buys stability. And because you got some there, interest is flowing through, because even though right now Malaysia's OPR, overnight policy rate, is 1.75%, and our FD rates are ranging, say, between 1.4% and 1.9%, nothing exciting, it's still possible that our FD rates will come down, you know, because Malaysia's economy is really in very, very bad shape. And so I wouldn't be surprised if in the next 1, 2, or 3 Bank Negara meetings, the OPR comes down either 25 or 50 basis points from 175 basis points, which is the same as 1.75%, all the way down to 150 basis points or 125. Even then, I will still keep some money and I'll still be earning a little bit of interest. So where does the passive income come from? The cash in the bank. You get some interest, a little bit. Then you put money into, say, local stocks or international stocks that pay dividends. You get your dividends. I'm 57 years old. I still keep quite a bit of my money in EPF. When EPF gives dividends, I get the dividends, passive income. When it comes to distributions, now because I am 18 years away from my targeted retirement, but because I have many retiree clients, for almost all my clients, when I build fund portfolios that are diversified across across asset classes, geographic regions, and across a long timeline, I almost always put them into funds that I own myself. And because I have to take care of retired clients, I've also structured a portion of my portfolio to also give me the cash-based distribution. then I track my own stuff, and then I can notify my clients as well. So cash distributions from unit trusts. And then the last bit would be, if you own a building, you can basically get rental flowing through. If you own REITs, at one stage, I actually owned every listed REIT in Malaysia. This is not because I have a lot of money. I bought very small positions in everything because it was the early days of REITs and I wanted to understand what was did that. And then later when more REITs came on, I didn't chase after them. And now the bulk of my REIT money is funds, but I still get a little bit of money coming in as REIT dividends. But my REIT funds give me REIT distributions in cash. And then the last... Oh, that's it. That's it. Those are the four types I was talking about. I hope I answered the question.
Okay. Any difference between public mutual unit trust and a private retirement saving plan?
No, you're comparing apples and oranges, kidneys and livers, okay? Public mutual is Malaysia's largest unit trust company. It is rock solid. It's very, very strong. Public Mutual's old name was KL Mutual. And in 1996, when I was the founding editor of Smart Investor magazine in Malaysia, I joined the Singapore team. I learned the system there. Then they moved me back to Malaysia. And I was the first editor of Smart Investor Malaysia. I did a cover story on the senior team of KL Mutual. Very good company. I got to know them. I was so impressed. I learned about dollar cost averaging in that story. And so I got to know them. I started putting my own money there and I stayed in touch with the senior management. When they wanted to write a financial planning book, they approached me. I put in a pitch for the job and I got that. And so in 1998, three senior people from KL Mutual and I wrote Financial Freedom, Your Guide to Lifetime Financial Planning. I was very happy when I put the final full stop to the first full draft. I thought, this is 98, 23 years ago. I leaned back in from my desk and I thought, if I die now, I've left my legacy. I was very proud of that. So I know the company. And then in 2000, we did the sequel, which was Financial Freedom 2 through Malaysian Equities and Unit Trusts. So I learned about stuff then as well. And then, but as a freelance writer at the time, I was perpetually broke. Bit like being a student in the UK, perpetually broke. And so one of my co-authors basically said, you know, you've written the books with us, maybe you shouldn't sell our competitors' products. And so he said, maybe you should become an agent for us. So I became an agent for KL Mutual and then they changed the name, Public Mutual. So I know the company very well. And then my friends moved from Public Mutual to the MAA Group and they started a company called Mackle Mutual. And I was the first Public Mutual agent to quit clean. I didn't use proxies or whatever. I sent in a resignation letter. I moved across to the new company and we built. Between 2004 and 2013, we built the assets of the new company from 260 million ringgit to 2.6 billion ringgit. In 9 years, we grew the assets tenfold. And then Manulife, which is my current principal company, bought Mackle Mutual lock, stock and barrel. So as I mentioned all these companies, what you must understand is these are unit trust companies, okay, whether it be my current unit trust company, which is Manulife Investment Management Malaysia Berhad, or whether it be Public Mutual, or whether it be CIMB's capital, principal. There are lots of very good companies. But PRS is actually a government initiative. And the PRS is overseen by the PPA, the Private Pension Administrator. And so there are only, to the best of my knowledge, there are only 8 PRS licensed entities. I believe Public Mutual is one. I know CIMB is one. I've got some of its PRS stuff. Manulife is also one. So it's different. It's a different product. And don't make the mistake of putting the product and the company together. So my short answer, rather than a long answer, my short answer is, no, they're different.
They're different.
Next question.
Okay, just a short one. Is ASM a good investment?
It might well be. I don't know very much about it. And generally speaking, when you look at the PNB funds, there are basically two types. You've got the funds that are opened to the Bumiputras, and then you got the funds that are open to all of us. Also within PNB, you've got those where the government backs ₱1 of value. So it doesn't matter what happens, you still get your ₱1. And there's the other one that fluctuates. My experience has taught me that for the ones that fluctuate, PNB doesn't do very well. But for those that are guaranteed by the government, even if the valuation drops, the government backs you up. So if ASM or say Awawasan, if all that falls in the same category, it's a good investment simply because the government is backing. But the question you got to ask yourself is, how strong are the government's finances? And when push comes to shove, what are they going to do, particularly in this Ketuanan Melayu environment? Do you guys know about the impending strike by the young doctors? Is it tomorrow? They are going to have a walkout? Okay. Now, about a month ago, when representatives from this unelected government came out, they basically said, we will do our best to make sure that the Malay or Bumi doctors get absorbed. And they said it very naturally. So from their perspective, very innocent. Of course, we take care of our own. That's the kind of thing that's happening. And the Malaysian Medical Association went ballistic and basically said, how can you do that? Everyone should be treated equally. And I don't think anyone paid any attention to it. So in this environment where money is very, very tight and the people in power are there for power, and I believe many of them are kleptocrats, I want to... The less I say right now, the better. But basically, I am distrustful. And so I would say in general, be careful and diversify as much as you can. Learn and be wise. Now, remember I told you that I actually keep money in EPF? My own money. I keep some of my own money in EPF. But some of my clients are so freaked out by what's going on, they're actually taking out. And then I keep telling them, look, I keep some money in EPF. I recommend that you keep some. The amount that you take out when you hit 55 or 60, if you want me to manage it and to use to build like the equivalent of a private pension, I'm happy to do it. See, it's in my self-interest for them to take out everything because the more money comes in, the more money I make. But I tell them I actually keep some of my own money there. So it's really a case of balancing because if you look at EPF's returns over the decades, it's done very, very well. The only problem is things are getting very, very scary right now. And so some people are very worried. Next question.
Okay, last two questions. Right. Could you share about capital preservation and capital liquidation, which you mentioned in the beginning of the talk?
Sure. So I use both these models for retirement funding. And in a capital preservation model, person works, saves, invests for decades, builds up a large capital sum. Typically between ₱3 million and ₱20 million. That's my usual range when I'm working with clients for a capital preservation portfolio. For capital liquidation, see, everyone may like capital preservation because what it means is when you hit retirement, you draw out yield, but the yield is less than the long-term growth of the portfolio, which means your portfolio continues to grow and maybe at the end of your life, the nominal value is actually larger than when you started. So that's why it's called capital preservation. And then remember, I said that for a complete financial plan, you got to have wealth protection, wealth accumulation, wealth distribution. With wealth distribution, the two tools are a will and trusts. And so if it's a will, you would have a lot of money to basically give your kids or to charity or whatever else if it's capital preservation. Capital liquidation, you don't have as much money. And so when you hit retirement, as my wife's uncle once told me, you're retired and then you potong bukit. And every time you cut the hill, you're using up some principal, some capital. And so to be able to compensate, if your capital sum shrinks, your capital sum goes from there to there, it shrinks. Yeah, I'm trying to get my fist in front of my face. Okay. As it shrinks, even if the general yield stays the same, the amount that you get is less. And therefore, you have to potong more of the bukit. So by definition, with capital liquidation, you die with your last ringgit spent and your children pay for your funeral. That's the difference. A bit morbid, but that is the difference. You said there's one more question?
Yes, one more question. I believe this is from a student. It says, should I save and manage my finances from PTPTN as a student on PTPTN study loan so that I'm able to get some profit and also to pay back my loan only when I start working?
I don't think the problem is very big in Malaysia, but the equivalent of PTPTN in Malaysia is actually the ballooning student loan crisis in the US. So I'm going to give you access. Basically, what you guys want to try and do is there is an American Christian financial guru whose name is Dave Ramsey. Dave, D-A-B-E, Ramsey is R-A-M-S-E-Y. Go do a Google search on him. Go check out the Ramsey Network. I subscribe so I can actually gain access to the stuff. I don't know whether you can gain access to the information if you're not subscribed. But his organization actually put together a multi-part series on the student loan crisis. And it's got so bad that there are adults, aging adults in America who feel like they cannot get ahead in life because they're just constantly paying their student loans. So my general advice is this. With the PTPTN money that you have, make sure that you study and you qualify. That is the most important thing. I don't think it is wise for you to invest your PTPTN money. I think it is better for you to save your PTPTN money, use it, try and control so that you don't use all of it when you graduate. Once you start your work, if you haven't finished using up all the money, take all of that money, go straight to PTPTN and say, I want to make a lump sum payment, bring down the loan. And then PTPTN is going to say, okay, once you start work or maybe 6 months or a year later, you got to pay us a few hundred ringgit. For those of you whose jobs can actually handle it, I want you to go there and tell them, I want to pay more. And try and get your PTPTN loan paid off in full within 2 years of starting work, if it's at all possible. If you can't do it, try and get it done in 3 or 4 years. But don't let the stupid loan stay with you. Try your best to get the loans out of your life so that you can actually enjoy your money, so that you're not paying 15 different creditors. And I tell you, it gets so frustrating sometimes because not all my clients use me for holistic financial planning. And I have some who are actually doing quite well, you know, like professionals doing very well, lawyers, etc. And I'm horrified, you know, that I know a client who at one stage actually owned a Ferrari, law firm Ferrari, did very, very well. But then his family's growing, so he sold the Ferrari, bought other big cars and stuff. You're welcome, Mary. But he went and bought some things, you know, and he had the money for it. But the reason that he put it on a time thing is because he said the credit card is 0% and then I can just stretch it out. And I'm trying to explain to him, look, every time you stretch it out like this, you're eating into your monthly cash flow and it reduces your capacity to actually save and invest on a regular basis and to just not have to worry about the debt. So, you know, everyone's got different ways of looking at it. Sometimes if you just look at the relative yield, what I'm saying doesn't make sense. But financial planning is a lot more than just looking at the yield, the interest rate. Financial planning is the process of meeting your life goals through the proper management of your finances. And one of those goals for most people is actually peace of mind, to not have to worry. Now, there are some people who actually want to take on a lot of risk and they're willing to do it, then by all means, you know, if you think you can do a differential, you can go into good debt, bad debt, that's fine. But for most of us, the older we get, the more crises we go through, the more we begin to value being able to trust God's word, where it basically says, let no debt remain outstanding except the debt of continuing love.
Right.
So that for me is the ideal. I'm still a long, long way from that, but you know, we try.
Well, thank you so much for
You're very welcome, Pastor Daniel.
I know we have taken more than your time, right, than what we have planned. And just to let you all know, Brother Rajan shared with us, and this is a free webinar. We really want to appreciate him and thank him for his invaluable lessons and teaching to us, and it has helped us a lot. Shall we give him a big round of applause? Thank you so much. Right. All right.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. God bless you. So are we ending right now? Should I leave right now, or do you want to do
something? Don't leave a moment, right? I want to pray for you also.
Please, thank you. Yes. Oh, actually, if you're going to be praying, may I ask you? So my sister's name is Viji, V-I-J-I. She is COVID-19 positive. Seremban Negeri. So it's not as bad as KL and Selangor, but our system is basically falling apart. So she was, this is Saturday, right? So she started to feel sick on Saturday. She told me on Sunday, I took her for the test on Monday. She was positive, marked positive on Tuesday. The health people are supposed to turn up within 24 hours to put a pink band and to assess. Till now, no one has turned up. Wow. And so I don't want her going into a quarantine center or the government hospital because the viral load is so high. But I've checked with a friend of mine in a private hospital, and if need be, I'll just send her there and just pay for it. But if you could pray for Viji, she seems to be getting better day by day. Her oxygen, blood oxygen level is like 97, 99, very, very good, solid. But today she told me she lost her sense of smell. So can you just pray that the disease runs a course and she's basically okay? Then my wife and I are taking her maid for the maid's first test and then our second test, because my wife has her second Sinovac jab on Tuesday. I have mine on Thursday. So it's a whole bunch of things. If you would pray for that, I'd be very grateful.
Yes, yes. All right. Once again, I want to thank everyone for joining us. We will try to have more sessions like this for our webinar from Canaan Church. So we hope you can join us. If you have any question, maybe you can connect with Brother Rajan, or if anything on emotional or spiritual, you can always contact with us, pastoral staff here. All right. We are so glad that you can join us. Let's close with a word of prayer. Amen. Father, once again, we thank you for this afternoon, for this extended time, and for all the things, the truth that we have learned. Father, we pray that all of us will be wise. Everything that we have learned, not just to let it bypass our ears, but to put it into practice, to be careful, to be safe, to plan ahead well. We know, God, you are a God that supplies our need, but we need to manage it well ourselves. May your principles continue to guide us, O God. And Lord, we thank you for Brother Rajan that has given us so much time and his invaluable lessons, all his experiences. Father, we pray firstly for his sister, Viji. Lord, has come down with COVID positive, O Lord. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we pray you stretch forth your hand, your healing hand, and touch her right now. Father, we thank you for the oxygen level is still good, and we pray for that sense of taste and all the other things that might be coming. In the name of Jesus, that all this will be totally gone, that the virus will totally be removed from her body, and from her bloodstream, from her whole body, oh God, all the organs will be cleared in Jesus' name. Father, we pray also for the entire family, Lord, Brother Regent's wife, even the maid, and all those who will be in contact with her. Lord, you protect the rest of the family that they will not contract this disease in Jesus' name, oh God. Father, we thank you, oh God. Thank you, oh Jesus. We can always cry out to you. You are our Savior. You are our healer. You are our protector. Thank you, O Jesus, once again. We continue to uphold Brother Rajan to you, Lord, that he will continue to be a blessing to many, many people, especially to the Christian community, O God. And even as he serves in BCM as a board, we thank you, O God, for people like this who are serving you and putting priority on you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. May your presence and your blessings and your protection go with all of us. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Pastor Daniel, thank you. Pastor David, thank you. Pastor Yvonne, thank you for being so strict and controlling everything. And a lot of people basically were saying thank you. So I want to just say you're welcome. God bless you. If anyone feels that your questions were not answered, not that I can answer everything, but you know, just check your notes, print out the notes. Okay, just print the hand.